Friends and relatives are to be cherished, but when it comes to money, you must be businesslike. If someone close asks you to co-sign a loan, make sure you know all that before you say yes. When you co-sign a loan, you are being asked to guarantee a debt. Think carefully, or it might ruin you. The U.S. Office of Consumer Affairs has a booklet with information on co-signing loans and solving your credit problems. It's called Buying and Borrowing, Cash In on the Facts, and it's available for 50 cents from Consumer Focus, Pueblo, Colorado, 81009.
Last person to announce us, please. Announcements? Sound familiar? You needed to hear the announcements, but all you heard was gossip. Well, now on WHJE, you can hear about your club meetings, party events, sports events, thanks to Instant Insight. First and Frank here is your host. Instant Insight will keep you informed. Tune in daily at 7 a.m. and 4 p.m. to catch up on the latest Carmel High School activities on your edge, WHJE.
Well, this is Chris Ernst, and I'm going to be out of here at 6 o'clock. Don't forget to stay tuned to Ted Gordon, who will be rocking it from 6 to 9 here on the Edge, WHJE.
voice of Central Indiana. Your
football team had its wildest football game of the season last Friday night. The team traveled north on State Road 37 to take on Marion, and once again the Hams proved to be giant killers as they knocked off their rated opponents 41-7. After three fumbles, Carmel landed in the end zone first thanks to this Toby Cole 1 yard scoring run.
They could get the first down without scoring a touchdown, but it will be very close. Big fourth down conversion try for the Greyhounds. Two tight ends, T formation. Cole gets a handoff and a touchdown, Greyhounds. Carmel Greyhounds draw first blood, 6 points on the board. Toby Cole goes in from about a yard out. And
after the point after, the score was 7-0, and the Carmel defense really dug in. They dropped Marion for a 1 yard loss after three downs and forced a punt. The Hounds turned this position into another 7 points when quarterback Bill Padgett ran for his fifth touchdown of the year.
So King, the center, leads him to the line of scrimmage. Padgett over center, two tight ends. T formation with Moore, Cole, and Sharp, the running backs. Padgett barks at the signals left and right. Handoff. He keeps it himself, rolling around the right side. That'll be touchdown, Greyhounds. Bill Padgett on the bootleg around the right side for the 8 yard scamper into the end zone.
Mark Levitt added the extra point, and the Hounds are on top, 14-0. On the next possession, Marion had the ball, fourth and one, just into Greyhound territory, and successfully fooled Carmel on this punt fake.
Has 17-yard line set to return the punt. This is a fake punt. It's a short snap. He's running upfield. That will be good enough for a first down. He's at the 45-yard line of the Carmel Greyhounds. That is the second fake punt we've seen in the last 2 weeks.
Carmel stopped that drive, and with just 3 seconds left on the clock in the first half, Marion had the ball and almost turned those 3 seconds into a touchdown.
First and 10 for the Marion Giants. Gannon over center with 3 seconds left. He drops back to pass, rolling a little bit to his right, throws it downfield. It is complete and a lateral on the right side. And he is continuing to run. He's inside the 40, tackled at the 35-yard line. Pass was complete to Jimmy Burke, the wide receiver. As soon as he caught the ball, he lateraled the ball back to number 26, Thompson.
Just into the second half and the third quarter, the Hounds fired up to the crowd on this 21-yard pass from Bill Padgett to Adam Ritz for a touchdown.
And three-back formation for the Greyhounds. Moore, Cole, and Sharp are the backs. Padgett, fake handoff, looking to the left side, complete is Adam Ritz. Touchdown, Adam Ritz. Carmel Greyhounds pick up another 6 points.
After Levitt converted the point after, the Hounds had a 21-0 lead. But the shutout wouldn't last long. On the first down of the next possession, the Giants showed some greatness when quarterback Steve Gagnon hit running back Richie Thompson open for this 36-yard pass.
Burke splits wide right. Goomery splits wide to the left. I formation behind Gannon. Gannon drops back to pass, looking deep down the right side for Burke. It is complete at the 20-yard line by Burke. Just an outstanding catch. That a 36-yard pass reception.
After the point after, the score was 21-7. The Hounds next took the ball on their next possession, 58 yards on 6 plays and 3 penalties for the touchdown from Toby Cole when he ran in from 2 yards. The drive was highlighted from this pass from Padgett to the Stallion running back.
In the shotgun formation, the Greyhounds have 3 wideouts, 2 to the right, 1 to the left. Padgett drops back to pass, heavy pressure from the backside. He dumps it off to Cole out of the backfield. He's at the 40, the 35, 30, 25, tripped up at about the 21-yard line. Ball will be marked right about there. There appears to be another flag down on the play.
Mark Levitt missed the extra point attempt, which broke a string of 27 straight good conversions by the Hounds place kicker, and Carmel had a 27-7 lead. The Hounds next scored on a fumble recovery. Tom Moore scooped up the ball and took it 45 yards for this touchdown.
Again, it comes to the line of scrimmage, shaking his head as he got his head rung going into the line of scrimmage. Wishbone formation, Thompson gets the call over the left side, and it's a fumble, and picking up down the right side goes Moore. That will be he's on the 5, touchdown Greyhounds, an unusual play. It looks like he just stripped the ball from him at the 45-yard line. Nobody really saw him until he was about at the 30-yard line, and he waltzed in for the touchdown.
The fourth quarter opened up on a penalty and fumble, and that's what the whole fourth quarter would be like. two fumbles and a punt later, the Carmel scored on the Giants when they had problems handling this punt snap.
Rickman, oh, it's a bad snap, gets by Rickman. The Greyhounds fumble, are in it, and it is David Kennedy. Touchdown Greyhounds. Touchdown Greyhounds. David Kennedy, it appears, picked up the ball on the goal line. And
that made the score 41-7. The Hounds had one more trip to the end zone. This time, John Bell picked up a fumble and ran it back for a touchdown, which would have been the third of the defense of the game. But it was called back on two penalties, and the ball game ended with the Hounds on top 41-7, and they knocked off 7th-rated Marion. In the fourth quarter, there were 6 fumbles, 8 penalties, and 1 interception. Hello again, everyone. I'm Nancy Deering. With me is Chuck Carmichael, and we're ready to bring you tonight's regional ball game as the Carmel Greyhounds play host to the number one ranked Penn Kingsmen in hopes of knocking off the Kingsmen to make it to the semi-state. We'll be back after this 60-second booster timeout for interviews with both coaches. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
Step Ahead Banking, a package of financial services and sound advice, only at Indiana National.
Generous contributions.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to our pregame show with head coach Jim Belton. Jim, quite a ball game over at Marion. Had a little bit of everything. I know a lot of things that a head coach would not like to see from his ball club, but it was a good, hard-hitting, and a great victory for the Greyhounds.
Well, it's a lot of fun to be a winner. Scott and this group of young people certainly have worked very hard, and to be a sectional champion really is a feather in the cap and a successful to cap off a successful season. Obviously, we get to go on the tournament, so that's exciting too.
You know, I saw the intensity from the Greyhounds throughout that ball game, and let's talk defensively too, because we shut down a great Marion offensive ball club.
Well, we were really concerned about Marion's speed. They really have featured two tailbacks or two halfbacks in the bone and the tailback through the year that have shown a great deal of speed, ones that can put points on the board very quickly. And we just have to be proud of the job that Keith Fiedler and our defensive staff has done. But we contained their offense extremely well. Our defense scores twice. That's just, boy, is that ice cream on the cake, I tell you, when your defense can score. So very proud of the way our defense played.
And a couple of things, Jim, that I noted throughout the ball game and looking at that defense, when you got backs like Marion does that can break it on any play, you've got to be able to stay at home, especially on the reverses or the flea flickers that they tried. And our guys did that exceptionally well and just played it beautifully.
They certainly did. Our outside linebackers did a great job. I thought our corners played good. They tried a flea flicker right at the end of the half, which even though it was successful for 25, 30 yards, we were willing to give up like that on the last play of the game. We just don't want to give a score. And then Tommy Moore sitting there and just waiting and give it time to our pursuit to get in after they had flipped that thing out there. So there were a lot of little plays and situations where we responded very well.
You turn it around on the offensive side, and for the most part throughout the ball game, after the defense made the plays, stopped Marion, caused the fumbles, whatever it might have been, the offense took advantage of it and put it in.
With the exception of the first time we had the ball, we still picked up a couple first downs, and then we had a fumble. Defense gets the ball back to us pretty quickly, and the offense goes in and scores. The next time we got the ball, we went in and scored. I think the next time or so, Scott, we fizzled a little bit or got involved in some penalties and then tried several desperation passes just before halftime in hopes to put some more points on the board. But then the third quarter really exploded, and along with the defense, and that was obviously the touch we needed for that game.
You know, I mentioned the intensity before, Jim, and really I think with the exception of when Marion scored their only touchdown of the ball game, the Greyhounds were up both offensively and defensively and played mentally strong throughout the ball game.
I really did. I would agree with you there. I thought that, you know, even though we were on a little longer trip than we normally are accustomed to, that's the first time we've dressed away. We just walked in the locker room, started dressing and taping for the game, and by the time we got comfortably in that position, we came out on the field, warmed up, played with emotion, and won the ball game and came back home. But we really didn't have any delays or didn't have any stay in there where we were sitting around for an hour or whatever it was, and the intensity and the emotion was there.
Well, those are two factors that have got to be there every week, and now you come into a ball game where you're playing the number one rated team in the state of Indiana, the Penn Kingsmen, and they're coached by a good friend of yours, Chris Giesman, who's been in this game a long time and has one state championship to his credit. So he knows what it takes also to get to the Dome and that championship.
Yeah, he certainly does. And, of course, Chris is a lot older guy than I am. He says he isn't, but he really is. You take a look now. He's got less hair than I do. Well, this is a lot of fun. This is, Scott, what I think teams work for is to be in a game like this. I'm not sure there's a loser in a game of this stature. That certainly doesn't mean that we want to be a loser. But on the other hand, this is a great opportunity for this group of people or players on our team that have had their backs to the wall and now have worked their way up to have a chance at playing number one. Should be an exciting game. It's going to be a great hitting game.
Last year, Jim, it was the regional and emotional, thrilling victory over Warren Central that propelled the Greyhounds. Is this the same kind of ball game where you've got to be that emotional and one that can really set the wheels in motion for a return date as defending champion?
Well, from one angle, I'm sure that's true. I don't think that the winner of this game can go out underestimating who's going to be in the semifinals. We've had that happen too before, where we went to the semifinals and lost down at Castle. But on the other hand, these are two good football teams, and it's kind of a game compared like we had with Warren Central last year. And this team, obviously, the winner of this game will have a good shot, certainly a legitimate contender for a state title.
Bit of deja vu playing the Kingsmen in the sense that their colors are black and gold, almost like Warren Central, and they are a team, Jim, that I've heard this phrase used, that mirror the Greyhounds. They do a lot of the same things that the Hounds do, both offensively and defensively.
With a little different in styles in terms of offense, they feature a little power pitch play like we feature a belly play. They feature two tight ends like we do. They'll split them out, maybe not quite as much as we do at occasions, but they're a good ball control offense. They would like to control that football and would like to control that clock. They believe in defense. They believe that you have to be a champion, you've got to play good, solid, fundamental defense. They pursue, they're well coached, they play with a lot of emotion. Very similar schools, very schools that have had success and therefore have a lot of pride and tradition.
Well, you get into a ball game like this, and I'm sure they have heard about what and seen on film what Toby Cole has done in the past couple of weeks. But really, we've got other weapons back there that we have not shown, specifically in our backfield with Mike Sharp and the option play, which really has not come into effect in the first 3 weeks of this tournament.
Not really, with the exception that I think Padgett has done a nice job when we've gone to the option. There are still some things that we have in our arsenal and a few different twists that we'll be using for this game that basically matches up a little bit better with their defense. Their defense obviously featured a great nose guard, and he's only a sophomore. But he's 6'2", 217, and nobody's just been able to block him. He certainly will be a test for us. We've got to win the battle in that one most of the time, or we're in trouble.
Jim, the average fan, and even the announcers to a certain extent, watch the ball and watch the backfield, but you're talking about matching up against Penn. You've got to give a lot of credit to your offensive line and to your offensive line coach, who comes up with the blocking schemes that will open up those holes for the backfield.
Right. John, of course, Pezzolano does a great job for us, and we work very close together on the offense. It's really going to be a war in the trenches. I think it's going to be a four-quarter war. Neither team is in the habit or are accustomed to or taught to quit. And it's just going to be a great war for four quarters right up there front.
What about a key for the Greyhounds tonight against Penn?
Boy, oh boy, it's hard to narrow it down. Most people say close games like this, or if we can stay in this ball game, may result in the kicking game. It may result in field position a little bit. Both teams like to control the football. It's hard to start down in the deep end of your own territory. You tend to want to be a little more conservative in that area. You don't want to give the ball up because the other team, if they've got a hold of it, they're just going to hold on to it. So maybe ball possession time might be important, whether or not one team can sustain any kind of drives against the other team. There's just going to be a lot of things, Scott. I think turnovers might be a real factor in the game, whether or not one can cause the other team to turn the ball over.
Jim, a question about the coin flip. If you're lucky enough to win the coin flip tonight, in a couple of the past ball games, you've deferred, and the other team has put their offense on the field first. Is that the philosophy going into tonight's game against Penn?
Well, I'm not going to tell you exactly yet, Scott, but that certainly will be a consideration. We'll take a look at the weather and see what's happening with the wind and everything else and consider whether or not it's going to stay or go away. But deferring means that you get the ball at the start of the second half, and if we win the toss, that could be a reality. That may be very much our choice, but that doesn't necessarily mean. We'll decide that probably right at game time.
Well, I know that that is now a tactic, really, that has come in the past couple of years since they instituted the rule, and we see that more often, where you do want that third quarter, which is a very important quarter in any ball game.
It really is. I guess at first, you know, people kind of shied away from deferring. It was like saying, you know, we don't really want the football right away. Or the other person looked at it, why, they're not going to do that. They're trying to tell us their defense is it, you know. So, but an intelligent look at it, you know, might say that you think it's more important to have the ball at the beginning of the second half than you do at the first half. And then there's some other things in there. Sometimes you tend to be a little more jittery on offense at the start of the ball game until you've had a few hits. So sometimes teams are thinking about that. So I guess it's on whatever side of the coin you are. You also know if you get the ball right away and you can go down and score, that's a momentum builder too. So obviously the average fan can always say, well, why didn't you take the ball? Or why did you do that? If you had the second guess.
Well, it's Friday the 13th, Jim. Let's hope that it's a lucky Friday the 13th for the Carmel Greyhounds on our home field, and it's got to be good playing a team the caliber of Penn on our own field where you can be in your normal routine going into the ball game.
Well, we won't worry about the 13th, and it's nice to be home. And, Scott, it's going to be a great football game.
Well, Jim, let's hope we can talk one more week, and regardless of what happens down here, if the Greyhounds win, we'll be on the road to either Highland or Valpo.
That'd be true. The winner will travel one way or the other, at least in our case. If we should happen to win, we'll either be at Highland or be at Valparaiso.
Well, one more time around, Jim, okay?
I'd love to.
Take them one at a time, as you've always said. And that's Jim Belden on our pregame show. We'll be back after this WHJ booster timeout with more on our pregame show. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
At Butler Toyota, our fussy customers won't pay what others do. But we love our fussy customers anyway.
Me too.
How can you tell the difference between a happy used car and a sad used car? Miles alone won't always tell.
We won't sell you a sad used car at any price. That's how.
Come see us at Butler Toyota. We just love fussy customers like you.
Me too.
Hey. Carmel. Cellular Systems is an authorized agent of GTE MobileNet Cellular Communications and carries many types of mobile, portable, and remote site telemetry cellular equipment. Call Cellular Systems for sales, leasing, and service at 844-3866. At Cellular Systems, located at 1118 South Rangeline Road in Carmel. Call 844-3866 for more information. WHJE would like to thank these super boosters for their generous contributions.
Well, welcome back to our pregame show. Our guest now is the coach of the Penn Kingsmen, Chris Giesman. And Chris, congratulations on a tremendous sectional win in what has to be the hardest sectional to fight your way through.
Well, I think it is. It may not be, the best teams in the state, but I think there's a lot of good teams, and I can't think of another section will be more balanced.
What about your pinball club this year? 11-0, never won over in the state. What's gotten you this far?
Well, I'll tell you, this is really a pleasant surprise for us. We're in sort of the same shape that Carmel was in. At the start of the year, we lost 19 out of 22 starters to graduation, and we had a couple of DBs and a tight end back, and we definitely thought this was going to be a rebuilding year. We were looking at 3 as a possible record, but that's a tribute to the young men. We're 11-0 and still here. We're not real big, we're not real fast, but we're playing with a lot of confidence.
Tell me about your starting back here, the men that we're going to be calling offensively. Who has been the leaders back there?
Well, unfortunately, we lost our leading rusher and our leading scorer in the Fort Wayne North playoff game, Mike Winslow. He has been released this week, and he has been practicing, but he still hasn't got back the quickness that he had. He may see some duty. He may see a lot, may see very little. It just depends how it goes. But we've got kind of mostly young backfield. We have a couple of juniors in our leading ground gainers and scorers, Mike Winslow and Dan Kaufman. Steve Hogg is probably the best blocker in our backfield. But, they're all averaging around 5 to 6 yards per track. We don't have really breakaway speed, don't really have great size. But Mike is a pretty good runner. And Mike Danny's our best, and Steve Hogg's our best blocker.
Defensively, any team that is 11-0 on the year has to have what I would claim to be an outstanding defense.
Well, I'll tell you, we're awful proud of them. Again, they're not very big, but they fly around. I'm probably going to be giving up an average of about 3 inches, about 35 pounds a man to Carmel's O-line, and Carmel comes off the ball as well as any team I've seen. And the Cole run behind the line like that, and we're going to have our hands full. Against most normal teams, take big splits, try to do a lot of things. We're pretty effective. I'm just very anxious to see what we do against Carmel size with a very, very tight split.
You've come through a rough Northern Indiana Conference schedule, untouched in the loss record. You've also come through what I've said is the toughest sectional in the state. Has this been a key to your ball club, the ability to fight through and keep that toughness in big ball games?
Yes, it definitely has. I think we're a lot like Carmel in the respect of we have high expectations for our team, and our kids expect to win most games. And I think that carries us through. Look at Carmel on film. It's almost like they're a carbon copy of us. I mean, they expect to win. They have a good program. They don't beat themselves. They do the little things well. The only thing that really concerns me is their size advantage. It's a pretty good advantage.
Do you have any added pressure being the number one team in the state and unbeaten coming into this ball game?
Well, I don't really think so. I don't know how they've played it up down in Carmel, but again, we've been ranked in the top 10 every year for the past 13 years. We've been ranked first 5 different years, and the year we won the state, we never got ranked higher than third, so I think our kids know that ratings don't mean much, and we really don't talk about being number one at all, to be honest with you.
What about a key for Penn against Carmel?
A key for Penn against Carmel is probably two things. Number one, on defense, just can't let them control the ball. We just can't let them come down the field, 5, 6, 8 yards and crack. The second thing is we lost our best defensive player with a broken wrist last week in Fort Wayne Snyder, which puts a little bit of a disadvantage. practice, so we're going to try to keep it simple. Run dive plays, run options, and football.
All right, Coach, congratulations on a great year thus far, and good luck against the Greyhounds tonight. Coach Chris Giesman, our guest on the pregame show, and we'll be back after this 60-second WHB booster timeout. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
When you go, when you want more, you eat before. Let your toppings incredible fry. Make no mistake, there's just one place that's us. Good to the very end. Pizza King Pizza, Pizza King Pizza. Make it good to the very end. Pizza King Pizza.
Pizza King Pizza is right next door. Call Pizza King in Carmel for your next pizza or stop by our restaurant at 902 South Rangeline Road. Call 848-7994 for our fast free delivery. Pizza King is open at 11 a.m. Monday through Friday for your lunchtime orders.
That makes us good to the very end.
That's 848-7994 for Pizza King Pizza.
Welcome back to Carmel High School. Yancey Deering and Kep Carmichael bringing you tonight's ball game where the Carmel Greyhounds will face number one ranked Penn. Penn, of course, coming into the game, number one ranked in the state. The Kingsmen have shown that they are definitely an excellent ball club. Kep, as we wait now for the starting lineups, the Greyhounds have deferred and won the toss. So, Kep, you want to read off now the offensive lineup for the Penn Kingsmen.
Starting off on the line for the Penn Kingsmen, at left tackle will be number 69, a senior, Dwayne Hutzel. Starting off at left guard, number 66, Trent Sawyer. At center, number 51, a big senior, 6'1", 197-pound, Steve Pritz. At right guard, number 68, Kyle Knight. He's a 6'1", 198-pound senior. Number 79 will be at right tackle, Eric Jerzak. The two tight ends for the Penn Kingsmen will be number 84, Tony Simak. He's a senior, 6'4", 180-pound. And the other tight end, number 88, Matt Milestrup, 12th grader, 6'1", 185-pounds. The backfield for the Penn Kingsmen, quarterback Rich Carlton will be wearing jersey number 11. The running backs will be number 24, Steve Hogg, and number 30, Dan Kaufman. Kaufman is a junior. The flanker back will be number 1, Ken Centilli. Starting defensive lineup for the Greyhounds will be at defensive end, David Kennedy. Defensive tackle, Rick Atkins and Drew McDonald. The nose guard will be Todd Green, and the other defensive end, Josh Malinchuk. The linebackers, number 44, Trent Decatur, and number 33, Joe Kaufman. The cornerbacks for the Greyhounds will be Mark Lavotte, number 21, and John Spidell, number 22. The safeties for the Greyhounds this evening, Tony Mefford, number 18, and Tom Moore, wearing jersey number 27.
Going into tonight's ball game, an interesting sideline note. Toby Cole is ranked 16th in the state, tied for 16th with a running back out of Crown Point by the name of John Young. Tied 16th in the state for Morris rushing touchdowns. So the Greyhounds definitely with a jewel in the backfield being Toby Cole. Now Mark Lavotte set to kick for the Greyhounds. Penn comes into the game, as we mentioned, number one ranked in the state, number 16th in the nation last night on Sports Edge. Coach Belden said he'd calculated that the Greyhounds are probably somewhere about 750th in the nation.
So Lavotte, the side one, right side kicker, gets off a good one. This one bounces inside the 10 and will roll into the end zone. The Greyhounds get a good roll that time, and the Penn Kingsmen will start off first and 10 on their own 20-yard line. Carmel Greyhounds taking on the Penn Kingsmen tonight in regional action. Once again, the backfield for the Penn Kingsmen, quarterback Rich Carlton, running backs number 24, Steve Hogg, and number 30, Dan Kaufman. The flanker back will be Ken Centilli. The two tight ends, C-Mac and Miles Strupp. So Carlton leads them to the line of scrimmage. Hogg and Kaufman are the running backs in the split formation. Coming out to the right flanker will be Miles Strupp. Now wide to the right is C-Mac. The pitch back right over the right side to Kaufman that time, and he is dropped for a short gain on the play. So it'll be second down and about 8 yards on the play.
Now, if we seem to have a little problem tonight, you'll have to bear with us. Our scoreboard out is, the scoreboard here at Carmel High School is out. The only thing they're showing is the ball location and the score. We will not have any idea of the time.
So second down, 8 yards to go for the first down. Carlton over center, two backs in the backfield, Winslow and Hogg are the running backs. One man out wide to the left. Carlton barks out the signals left and right. Over the left side to Winslow that time, and he gets forward for a couple yards on the play. He's over the 25. Ball will be marked around the 26-yard line, so it'll be third down and four for the first down situation for the Penn Kingsmen. A gain of four on the play. Coming in, checking in for the Kingsmen, number 87, Tim Hawthorne, a 6-foot, 178-pound senior, and checking out for the Kingsmen is Tim Centilli. Coming to the line of scrimmage, leading him to the line of scrimmage, center Steve Pritz. Carlton over center, split formation behind him. Kaufman and Hogg are the running backs. One man out wide to the right, the other out wide to the left. Now Hogg moves in motion to the left. Carlton drops back to pass, looking over the left side. It is complete on over the 40-yard line. Reception that time, Dave Smale. Incomplete, rather, on the play. Smale was the intended receiver at the 40-yard line. Ball was behind him, and he couldn't quite recover for it. It looked like he might have pulled it in. It did drop before he could pull it in.
Interesting point. We see an addition to the Greyhound defense on the punt. Mark Elliott, a sophomore in for the Greyhounds. A couple key sophomores in the game for both teams. Ron Herman, a sophomore, back to receive this punt near his own 40-yard line.
So Ron Herman back to receive his punt. It's a low punt. Ron Herman will let it bounce, and now fielded at the 35-yard line. Dives forward just across to the 36-yard line. Big stop put on the play that time by the Penn Kingsmen. It looked as if Herman had a little bit of hard time catching his footing. So the Greyhounds will take over first and 10 on their own 36-yard line for their first possession this game.
A name to watch, Chris Bulling, a 5'6", 160-pound, they have him listed as a junior, the noseman for Penn, the noseman comes in number 78, Aaron Weiberger. Watch him a lot this evening.
Padgett over center, I formation behind him, Cole and Sharp on the running back. Sharp gets the call right over the middle, gets some good yardage over the 40-yard line. He's up to around the 42-yard line. Good pickup of about 6 yards on the play that time for the Greyhounds. Starting offensive line for the Greyhounds, of course, is Hebert, Bowen, King, Towner, and Pesek, the interior lineman. Ritz, the tight end. Gunderson, the split end. And Harrington, the flanker back. Padgett, the quarterback. Cole, the fullback. And Sharp is the tailback. Sharp and Cole in the backfield this time in the split formation behind him. Taylor comes wide to the left. Handsman out wide to the right. Handoff right up the middle to Cole over the left side, and he is stopped right on the line of scrimmage for no gain on the play. Big stop put in there that time by the noseman on the Kingsman, Aaron Weinberger.
If the Kingsmen are going to stop the Greyhounds, they definitely need to stop Toby Cole. Toby, the leading rusher for the Greyhounds, 21 touchdowns so far this year. Also the leading man with rushing, so he's definitely a force to stop.
Third and four for the Greyhounds. Big down here. Greyhounds showing the I formation behind Padgett. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Two men out wide, left and right. Padgett fumbles the snap, now recovers, drops back to pass, looking over the middle. It is complete to Adam Ritz, the tight end, coming off the line. That is good enough for the first down around the 45-yard line. Great catch that time for Ritz, leaping up, grabbing it for the first down. Padgett is one for one in the air this evening. Great catch by Ritz once again. The ball was high. He leaped up there, pulled it in for the first down. Big gain of 14 yards on the play. So it'll be first and 10 for the Greyhounds inside Penn territory at the 45. King leads him to the line of scrimmage. Padgett sets up over center. Greyhounds once again showing a lot of movement. Now they're showing the three back in the backfield. Cole gets a run right around the left side. He is dropped after a big gain. Good enough for the first down, but there is a penalty flag on the play. Cole bursts over the left side that time for a good about 14 yards on the carry, but there is a penalty flag on the play, so hold everything. We'll see what the call is.
That one in the Greyhound backfield. It could be an illegal motion call against the Greyhounds. We saw Pesek come from the right side, rush into the left, trying to get into the line of scrimmage, but that 5-yard penalty does go against the Greyhounds. It is illegal motion against the Greyhounds, one of the offensive linemen, so that penalty is going to bring up now first down and 15. So Carmel now needs to move the ball again big.
So the Greyhounds come to the line of scrimmage, a big first and 15 Down play for the Grounds. They're showing the wishbone formation behind Padgett. Two tight ends. Handoff goes to Sharp right up the middle. He is dropped for no gain at all. Well, big stop put on the play that time. Number 67, Rod Schmidt, a junior, 207-pound, 5'10" athlete with a big stop that time for no gain. So Moore and Ryan Herman check out of the ballgame. Hansman checking back in for the Greyhounds. They'll face a second down, 15 yards to go for the first down. King leads him to the line of scrimmage. Padgett sets up over center, showing the pro set behind him. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Hansman moves in motion to the right. Taylor already set to the left. Padgett drops back to pass, rolling to his right, looking downfield. He's going to run it. He turns it upfield, getting just a couple yards that time. He's over midfield to about the 48-yard line of Penn, but they will face a third down and about 14 yards for the first down after a gain of about one on the play. So the Greyhounds facing a definite passing play here for the Greyhounds.
One point kept. If Carmel didn't get that penalty, Toby Cole would have moved the ball to about the 30-yard line, so we wouldn't have had this mess. Now it's third down and 13. The Greyhounds definitely need to put it up. Watch Adam Ritz or Pete Harrington.
Harrington and Gunderson split wide to the left. Pat dropped back in the shotgun formation. Cole and Sharp are in the backfield along with him. He barks out the signs left and right. Drops back to pass now, looking downfield. Good protection, unleashes it. It is intercepted that time. It hit off Harrington's shoulders. He brings it up over midfield to the 48-yard line of the Carmel Greyhounds. Then getting the interception was the safety, Brian Boyer, 5'10", 163-pound athlete. Hit off the shoulder pads of Harrington, picked off in the air by Boyer, and he brought it back to the 47-yard line of the Carmel Greyhounds. Big interception there against the Greyhounds. Penn will take over first and 10 inside Greyhound territory on the 47-yard line. Carlton takes it to the line of scrimmage, first and 10. In the backfield, Hogg and Kaufman are his running backs. One man out, split wide to the left. Two tight ends in for the Kingsmen. Carlton barks out the signals left and right. Handoff right up the middle that time. Carrier on the play, number 32, Paul Jordan, for a short carry. Gain of two on the play. So it'll be second down and 8 for the Greyhounds, for the Penn Kingsmen on the 45-yard line of the Greyhounds. Second down, 8 yards to go. Leading him to the line of scrimmage, Steve Pritz for the Penn Kingsmen. Centilli is split wide to the right. There is a official timeout on the field. Possibly it is an equipment timeout here on the field.
Boy, Cap, this could really turn into a big defensive battle right now. Our score is 0-0. We're just halfway about through the first quarter, and both teams have had opportunities but have messed up. So it looks like it's going to be a heck of a defensive battle here from Carmel High School.
Kaufman and Hogg in the backfield behind Carlton, the quarterback. He drops back to pass, looking downfield, unleashes one. It is complete at the 10-yard line and is dropped inside the 10 around the 5. Reception that time by Tony Semak, the tight end and split end, pulling it in. A big play by the Penn Kingsmen. He has been a senior leader all year long for the Penn Kingsmen. So it'll be first and 10 inside the first and goal to go inside the 10-yard line for the Penn Kingsmen. It's first and goal to go from the 7-yard line. They take it to the line of scrimmage. Three men in the backfield and two tight ends for the Penn Kingsmen. Carlton barks out the signals left and right. Handoff right over the right side. Touch. He has dropped inside the 5-yard line. One of the referees was calling a touchdown. He was set up on the 5-yard line. He saw him go over the 5-yard line, put up his hands, but he was not inside, was not over the goal line. In on the carry that time, Mike Winslow picking up a gain of a couple yards on the play. It'll be second and goal from the 3-yard line, so a short pickup that time by the Kingsmen. They take it to the line of scrimmage. Second and goal to go from the 3-yard line. Carlton over center. Hogg, Kaufman, and Winslow are the running backs behind him. Two tight ends. Barks out the signals. Handoff over the right side. Once again, Kaufman gets the call. Touchdown, Penn Kingsmen. They break the ice first on a 3-yard run for the Kingsmen. So they take the lead 6-0. The Kingsmen capitalize on a Carmel turnover and march it a good 47 yards for the touchdown. on a minimum of plays after a 41-pass completion from Carlton to C-Mac, and then Kaufman punched it over for the 3-yard gain. Now coming in for the point after attempt for the Kingsmen. Long count for the point after attempt. The snap is good, the kick is up, and it is good. He just got it over the crossbar. That was a line drive shot that just got over the crossbar. So 7-0 in favor of the Penn Kingsmen.
Well, that was very close, Cap. They're calling that good. We must have had a very bad angle on it, because that looks like it went under the crossbar from up here, but no doubt, it doesn't matter what we think, it's the referees. You know, a lot of emotion in this ball game. We see signs, which usually aren't allowed, and flags, which usually aren't allowed in IHSA events. People have snuck in bullhorns and everything. Very much of a heated battle. The Greyhounds now need a big drive. They're going to send Gunderson and Moore are the up men. Herman, along with Harrington, go back deep to receive for the Greyhounds. So we saw their pen with a little bit of jitters, possibly after the four plays and 50 yards for the touchdown. So I think that Penn might have to, on that point after, could have been a little shaky. So both teams, I'm sure, that way. Helmets raised on the Greyhound side.
So the kick is a very high one going over to field. It will be Herman inside the 5-yard line. Brings it up to the 10. Now moving off to the left side at the 15, the 20, the 25, over the 30. Dropped at the 30. Fumble on the play. That is recovered by the Penn Kingsmen. Recovered by number 44, Dave Smale, recovering the fumble that time. Herman had a lot of open room, a lost handle of the ball, and it is recovered by the Penn Kingsmen inside the 40-yard line at the 38-yard line of the Carmel Greyhounds.
The Greyhounds need to cause a turnover. They can't let Penn get a first down. If Penn's going to punt, it's going to put the Greyhounds in awful field position. They definitely need a turnover now, which is something the Greyhounds are very accustomed to after last week.
So Carlton takes him to the line of scrimmage. Two backs in the backfield. They are Kaufman and Fogg. Carlton over center, two men out wide, left and right. Carlton drops back to pass. Now he's going to run it upfield. He's to the 35 and dragged down from behind that time. David Kennedy in on the tackle that time after a good gain on the play inside the 35 to the 32-yard line of the Carmel Greyhounds. It'll be second down and about 2.5 yards to go for the first down. First down marker is just inside the Carmel 30-yard line. Carlton over center, split formation behind him. Winslow and Fogg are the running backs. Two tight ends in the ballgame, one flanker back, split wide to the left. Carlton over center barks out the signals. Hand off to Fogg, right up the middle, dropped after a very short gain on the play. The ball will be marked on the 30-yard line. A gain of about 2 on the play, so it'll be third down and a short 1 yard to go for the first down. Big play here for the Carmel Greyhounds. They have to stop them here.
The Greyhounds need to get a stop back behind the line of scrimmage. Watch the front line. Really needs to stay down on a play like this. A key on this play is the offensive front line. If they pop up, that is when the Greyhounds can make a stop. If they stay low, it'd be nearly impossible to stop a first down.
Winslow and Kaufman are the running backs in the split formation. Third down and one, under 2 minutes to play in the first quarter. Pitchback is a fumble on the play, and it appears to be recovered by Kaufman. The pitchback was to Kaufman. He fumbled the ball, recovered it, but it will be fourth down. They lost a couple of yards on the play. Lost about 3 yards on the play, so it'll be fourth down. Fourth down and 5 for the Kingsmen on the 34-yard line of the Carmel Greyhounds. So they do come in and they will be punting. Coming in to punt will be Jim Barnett. There is no one back deep for the Carmel Greyhounds.
Timeout taken on the field. We'll be back after this 60-second booster timeout. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds. We'll be right back.
Step Ahead Banking, a package of financial services and sound advice, only at Indiana National. Added to the list.
Back to, well, it's fourth down and five, and Penn appears to be going for it.
Carlton comes to the line of scrimmage, sets up over center, split formation behind him, two-man out wide, left and right. Carlton drops back to pass, looking over the center. Good protection, now going deep to the end zone. It is intercepted by the Carmel Grounds in the end zone. He's going to bring it out. He's at the 10, the 15, breaks it up. He's over the 20-yard line to the 22-yard line. Pass was intended that time for number 80, the split end, Mark Sampson. The interception was good, so the Carmel Grounds will take over the 20-yard line. First and 10 at the 21-yard line.
Tell you what, Kep, if Levi would have thought of it that quick, needed to let go of that ball, not catch it, just let it drop. The Greyhounds would have had a lot better field position, but no doubt an interception could really turn the tides. A packed house here, a lot of emotion in the game. The winner of this ball game is going to be whoever can get momentum going their way. So far, it's been Penn.
Padgett sets up over center, split formation behind him. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Two tight ends, rather a wishbone formation with two tight ends. Sharp gets the call over the right side, dropped for a gain of nothing on the play, possibly a loss. Rather, no gain on the play. Sharp gets the carry.
Tell you, Penn brought a full house. We've never seen a capacity crowd. At least I've never seen a capacity crowd on the far side of a Carmel High School football field filled with the visitors. And this, they brought in full. They're sitting in the aisles, Kep. There's a lot of people here for Penn.
So the Greyhounds come to the line of scrimmage. Two tight ends, one flanker back out wide to the right. That's Hansman. Cole and Sharp are in the I formation. Sharp gets the call over the left side. Dropped after a short gain. He's up to about the 35-yard line. Gain of five on the play for Sharp.
Now is when you definitely can see a big pass, probably to the likes of someone, maybe possibly even Adam Ritz, a tight end for the Greyhounds, has had more touchdown passes than any other Greyhound this year. So it could go to Ritz to pick up the 7 yards needed for a first down.
Third and seven. I formation behind Padgett for the Greyhounds. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Gunderson is split wide to the right. The option play, it'll given it to Sharp around the right side. Drop for no gain on the play at all. Penn was right there stopping him for no gain. So it will be fourth down for the Carmel Greyhounds. And Rasmussen coming in from the sidelines for the Greyhounds to punt the ball away.
So the Greyhounds burn again. That time all three times went to Sharp. Picked up about 4 yards on the play. It's fourth and six. The Greyhounds are going to be punting from about their own 25-yard line is where the line of scrimmage is.
Rasmussen back on his own 10-yard line to kick the ball away. He gets a low end-over-end kick that hits at the 45-yard line. Fielded at the 40-yard line is stuck right there. Tom Moore just absolutely drilled him right there on the hit.
So Tom Moore, definitely, you saw the man deep to receive. The ball bounced, and he didn't call a fair catch. And Moore just came in and abused him, said, I'll teach you next time to use a fair catch. So now Penn is going to start off at about their own 38-yard line. Just a few seconds left to go here in the first quarter. As a matter of fact, that is the end of the first quarter. As we said, we don't have a scoreboard clock working, so we're just going to have to go by our own sense of what we feel is going on. So at this point, the Greyhounds are down 7-0. Kep, this is a lot like a game last year. As a matter of fact, the regional game, Penn wears black and white. Last year it was Warren Center wearing black and white. Warren had a near-capacity crowd on the opposing sidelines. That score came down to an 8-7 ball game, if you remember. That really was a springboard for Carmel. That really kind of pushed them over the hump and really helped them as they came on to the rest of the state tournament. And that's what this kind of game can do for either of these teams.
Carlton will set up over center to start the second quarter. Winslow and Fogg are in the split formation behind him. One man is out wide to the right. Carlton barks out the signals to his teammates. He hands it off right up the middle to Winslow. Winslow gets a short gain on the play of about 5 yards. So Winslow busts through and will be second down and about 5 yards for the first down. Kingsman already picking up 27 yards on the ground tonight. and 41 in the air, so they've had some good production, offensive production, all night long. Second quarter, just going into the second quarter, Penn Kingsman on top, 7-0. Carlton sets up over center, split formation behind him. Winslow and Fogg are the running backs, one man out wide to the right. Carlton barks out the signals, hands off right up the middle to Fogg. He has hit at the line of scrimmage, but continues to lunge forward for a good carry on the play. He's up to the 47-yard line of the Penn Giants. It'll be second down and short. So it'll be gain of four, third down for the Penn Giants, third down and a very short one. Carlton sets up over center. Winslow and Hogg are the running backs behind it. One man split wide to the right. That is Hawthorne. Flanker back off to the right. Carlton barks out the signals. Pitch back to Winslow around the right side, and he is dropped without getting the first down. No gain on the play. A lot of grounds in there, tripping him off over the right side, and the Penn Kingsmen will face a fourth down situation.
So now will Penn punt? Last time in this situation, they didn't, if you remember. They went ahead and went for it. But it does look like they do bring out a punting crew. Ron Herman now down to about his 20-yard line to receive. He's had a little problem so far in the ball game, though, receiving. Hopefully he can hold on to the ball.
Jim Barnett comes in to do the punting at the 35-yard line. He gets a low kickoff. That will be let bounce at the 20-yard line, and Herman will just leave it right there. It drops inside the 20-yard line, around the 17-yard line, down there by Dave Kyle for the Penn Kingsmen.
I tell you, Cap, the Greyhounds just had a slight problem on that play. We saw Brian Vaughn come in for the Greyhounds, or rather try to leave the game, then comes back in. He thought he was a 12th man on the field. Atkins tried to call timeout, but the snap came through. And that might have been why the Greyhounds didn't get much protection there on the front line, was just because of that. So we see the Penn band now is here at Carmel High School.
Padgett sets up over center, the split formation behind him. Colin Sharp are the running back. Two men out wide to the right, one man out wide to the left. Padgett will keep it right up the middle, get some good yards at times. He's over the 20 to about the 24-yard line. He gets a pickup about 5 yards on the play. It'll be second down and 5 for the Carmel Greyhounds. Padgett on the air has had carried the ball a couple of times in the air. He has 58 carries for 241 yards on the air, a 4.2 average. He also has 5 touchdowns on the ground. So King leads him to the line of scrimmage. Padgett sets up over center. A lot of movement once again for the Greyhounds. Harrington and Gunderson split wide to the right. Cole and Sharp are in the pro set behind Padgett. Cole gets the call over the right side and is dropped for another short gain on the play. He is close to the first down. He will be short just by about 1 yard, a gain of about 2 yards, rather gain of about 4 yards on the play. So it'll be third down and 1 for the Carmel Greyhounds.
Watch it to go to Toby Cole. Greyhounds will use somewhat of a belly series now, even though two backs. So watch it probably to go to Cole on this play.
I formation behind Padgett. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Two men are split wide to the left, one man out wide to the right. Cole gets the call, hit at the line of scrimmage, and will not get any farther. He is dropped for a loss of about 1 on the play. So it'll be fourth down and 2 for the Greyhounds. And once again, Chris Rasmussen comes in for the Greyhounds to punt the ball away.
Greyhounds just aren't getting any holes open on the play all night long, so that could be a major factor as the game goes on. Now it's fourth down, and here comes the Greyhound punt crew once again.
Rasmussen back on his own 10-yard line, set to kick it away. He gets a good punt off this time. This one is a beauty that will be caught around the 37-yard line, and once again, Tom Moore is right there to hit him down for no return. Tony Simak right there to catch the ball, but Moore was just there to clean his clock right when he caught the ball, so no return on an excellent punt by Chris Rasmussen. The Penn Kingsmen will take over first and 10 on the 35-yard line. Penn on top, 7-0 here in the second quarter. Carmel Greyhounds really haven't been able to get anything going offensive-wise. Penn's defense has been like a stone wall trying to go through all night. Now the offense for Penn comes out onto the field. Hogg and Winslow are the running backs behind him in the split formation, one man out wide to the right. Carlton barks out the signals, handoff goes to Hogg over the right side, and he is dropped for no gain on the play. He is hit on the line of scrimmage, and he might have even just lost a couple feet on the play. A lot of Greyhounds in there, including David Kennedy, Rick Atkins, all in there making a big stop for the Greyhounds. So it'll be second down and 10 for the Penn Kingsmen.
So the Greyhounds, they stopped the forward motion, unfortunately, instead of getting him back. Something to note, Cap, if you see the Penn in the huddle, they all hold hands on that offensive line. Shows a lot of team unity, which adds to the emotion in this evening's ball game.
C-Mac is split wide to the left, Centelli wide to the right. Hogg and Winslow are the running backs. It is flash and pass. Carlton drops back to pass, looking down, incomplete at the 35-yard line. C-Mac was the intended receiver coming off the left side. It was incomplete at the 35-yard line, so it'll be third down and 10 for the Penn Kingsmen. Definite passing situation here.
Spied Alan Moore doing an excellent job on that play. You got to be very cautious not to bump into the receiver. You don't want to give him any extra yardage. And excellent coverage by the Greyhounds. You know, as we mentioned, Penn, they really take a lot of time in the huddle, but once they actually get in the huddle, it's bang, they're at the line, then they take a lot of time over the line. We could see possibly a delay of game penalty. Greyhounds showing tornado.
Carlton over center, split formation behind him. Winslow and Hogg are the running backs. Carlton drops back to pass, a lot of pressure from the right side, and he will be fumble on the play, or scramble for the ball, and it is Greyhound football on the 20-yard line. The Greyhounds recover the fumble. A lot of pressure from the backside, knock the ball loose, and the Greyhounds take over first and 10.
So the Greyhounds get an excellent break there. As we said, turnovers in a ball game like this, you've got jitters, and when a team can cause turnovers and get them, that one was definitely caused. A couple games, the Hounds have had a lot of turnovers in their favor, not necessarily caused. That one definitely the Greyhounds caused.
First and 10 for the Greyhounds on the 30-yard line. I formation behind Padgett. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Gunderson split wide right, and Harrington out wide left. Padgett drops back the pass, now rolling to his right. He's going to keep it. He's going to the 30, the 25, the 20, the 15, and dropped inside the 15-yard line around the 13-yard line, of the Carmel Greyhounds. A great pickup that time of about 17 yards on the play for Padgett.
Bill Padgett not afraid to run the football. As we see, he takes a lot of big hits. It kind of scares the coaches. You sometimes just see Coach Belden with a pile of fingernails underneath him. A little nervous to see Padgett run like that, and he is not afraid to take a hit.
First and 10 for the Greyhounds on the 12-yard line. Two tight ends, three backs in the backfield. Moore, Sharp, and Cole are the running backs. Padgett barks out the signals left and right. He's going to run the option play. He's going to keep it right up inside, and he is dropped for a gain of about 1 yard, if even that much, on the play. A lot of Penn Kingsmen there to put the stop on him. He does pick up a yard on the play, so it'll be second down and about 9 yards to go for the first down. Checking out for the Greyhounds are Moore and Ryan Herman. Checking in are Hansman and Taylor for the Greyhounds. Look for him to go to the air here.
Bill Padgett is leading the Greyhounds 25 yards on 4 carries. Next comes Sharp with 10 yards. Timeout taken on the field, and that gives us time. We'll be back after this 60-second booster timeout. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
At Butler Toyota, our fussy customers won't pay what others do, but we love our fussy customers anyway.
Me too.
How can you tell the difference between a happy used car and a sad used car? Miles alone won't always tell.
We won't sell you a sad used car at any price. That's how.
Come see us at Butler Toyota. We just love fussy customers like you.
Me too.
Our fussy customers won't pay what others do. They're fussy about the price they're paying. Fussy about service too. That's why we're saying, here at Butler Toyota, we love fussy customers like you, like you.
Missions.
Welcome back, Carmel High School. And the Carmel fans kind of excited. Now, an IHSA rule and the interpretation done by the officials and the referees has just said that the
either band, the Penn band is the one they've had the problems with, cannot play while play is going on, and that has been the case.
Second down, 9 yards to go for the Greyhounds from the 13-yard line. Paget over center, pro set behind him, Colin Sharp are the running backs. Taylor is wide right, Hansman wide left. Paget drops back to pass, rolling to his right, looking to the end zone, incomplete, intended receiver that time was Jeff Taylor over on the right side on the goal line, incomplete. He underthrew him by just a couple feet that time. The Greyhounds will face 3rd and 9 here inside Penn territory at the 12 or about the 12-yard line of Penn. 3rd down and 9 to go for the first down. We're into the second quarter here from Carmel High School. Penn Kingsman on top, 7-0. King leads him to the huddle. Splitting out wide to the right is Harrington. Out wide to the left is Gunderson. I formation behind Paget. Colin Sharp are the running backs. The emotion builds here at Carmel High School. Paget barks the signals. He drops back to pass, looking down field. It is incomplete. Intended receiver was Toby Cole, just around the line of scrimmage. It hit his fingertips and dropped off. Now the Greyhounds are facing a big dilemma here. It is 4th down and 9 yards to go inside the 15-yard line at the 12-yard line. They have not kicked a field goal all year long. We have a timeout on the field. Carmel High School taking it, so it gives us time to take the 60-second booster timeout. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
Our thanks go out to the following WHJ boosters: Mike and Claire Schmidt and family, James J. Schneider, CPA, attorney, Mr. and Mrs. Benjamin Schneider, William R. Schnell family, Donald B. Scholler and family, Earl Pat Schopp and family, Ron K. Schumann, Mr. and Mrs. D. Reed Sism, Charles and Dorothy Scott, Mark Seeley, Tom and Evelyn Seeley, Ralph and Suzanne Serrano, Yvonne, Diane, and Greg Shaheen, Pry Sharp, Realtor, David Shepard, Donald R. and Rosie Siegel, Moe and Judy Silverman, Dorothy and Joe Samala, Margie and Gordon Sims, the Roger Sinner family, Denny and Donna Schemes. If you would like to be a WHJ booster, just send $15 for your family, $25 for your business to the WHJ Booster Club, 520 East Main Street, Carmel, Indiana, 46032.
Welcome back to Carmel High School. Yancey Darian and Cap Carmel. We'd like to add a booster to that, a new booster, Prestige Portraits by Life Touch. Another booster we appreciate theirs and all our booster support that we've had throughout the year. It's all come down to the rest. The regional ball game at Kep, there's enough emotion to this game to be a state game. All the crowd here and how crazy it is.
4th down and 9 yards to go for the first down inside the 15-yard line. Paget drops back in the shotgun formation, sending two men out wide to the right. Hansman and Taylor. Paget drops back to pass, looking downfield in the end zone. It is complete for Ritz in the end. Touchdown, Greyhounds. Ritz catches the ball in the end zone for the touchdown. A 12-yard reception from Paget to Ritz. He just passed it right over the hands of the defender. Ritz pulls in a touchdown for the Greyhounds. 6-7 our score here. Carmel Greyhounds attempting the extra point after.
Cap, we see the Greyhounds line up on the right. All year long, there's a hurt Greyhound down on the field. Looks just to be shaken up. We're not sure at all who it is. We've seen the Greyhounds line up on the right like that all season long. And the latter part of the season, they do some fakes, or they haven't even faked one yet, always moving to the left. We could see that happen. The Greyhound down on the field looks hurt, so we're going to take a timeout here, a 60-second booster timeout. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
Pizza King Pizza is right next door. Call Pizza King in Carmel for your next pizza or stop by our restaurant at 902 South Rangeline Road. Call 848-7994 for our fast free delivery. Pizza King is open at 11 a.m. Monday through Friday for your lunchtime orders. That makes us It's 848-7994 for Pizza King Pizza. Main Street, Carmel, Indiana, 46032.
Carmel's best music. You've got the edge. WHJE Carmel.
Welcome back to Carmel High School. The hurt player on the field was Bill Padgett. We see he's standing on those sidelines. He's okay. He's got his helmet off. He's talking, saying, guys, I need some protection. Something more important, the extra point by Mark Lovatt, they say, wide to the right. And again, we must just have an awful angle on that field goal tonight because it looked pretty different from up here. But and the crowd saying it too. But no matter what, the score now stands Carmel 6 and Penn 7 here in the regional action from Carmel High School. Yancey Durian kept Carmichael Lovatt now on the kick.
Lovatt will kick it from the right side. This is a low kick. Will bounce at the 10-yard line, field it at the 5-yard line, brings it up to the 15, the 20, taking over the right side, dropped at the 25-yard line. Returning the punt that time was Matt Leith. Leith brings it up a good 20 yards to the 25-yard line. It'll be first and 10 for the Penn Kingsmen on their 25-yard line. We're into the second quarter, not sure how many minutes are left in the second quarter. We are without a scoreboard clock this evening, so we'll be estimating we're about halfway through the second quarter. So over center is Carlton. Behind him is Hogg and Winslow are the running backs. Two tight ends and one man, the flanker back, split wide to the right. Carlton barks the signals. He hands it off to Hogg right up the middle, and he lunges forward for a few yards, but this Carmel Greyhound defense is very psyched up right here. He picks up about 3 yards on the play, so it'll be second down and 7 for the Penn Kingsmen.
So Penn primarily keeping it on the ground, as is both teams. Greyhounds now looking for a big stop, bring the offense back on. Probably around 3 or 4, possibly 5 minutes even left to go here in the second quarter. Again, we're not exactly sure of the time.
Hogg checks out. Checking in for them as Kaufman and Winslow are the running backs behind Carlton. One man split wide to the right. Handoff right up the middle that time to Winslow, and he gets just a couple more yards. The Greyhound defense is really stacking him up at the line of scrimmage. Rather, no gain on the play that time for the Penn Kingsmen. Todd Green coming in there, the nose tackle for the Greyhounds, in coming in with a big stop. It'll be third down and 7 for the Penn Kingsmen. The Greyhounds now having Brian Vaughn, Todd King, and Rick Atkins check out of the ballgame, putting in a couple more speedy defensive back and linebackers in there for the Carmel Greyhounds. Passing situation here for the Penn Kingsmen. Carlton, there's an official timeout here on the field. We'll check to see.
Probably a time check, Cap. One thing that we've noticed so far tonight, Carmel is using a lot of substitutions in on defense. Really a little bit different. Usually we see Carmel, the kind of defense, they'll sit, they'll shift, they'll move. But now they're just pretty much putting in their people where they want them, and we haven't seen a lot of shifting on the Greyhounds.
So third and 7 for the Penn Kingsmen. Carlton over center, one man out wide to the left. Now he's moving in motion. That's Centilli to the right. Carlton drops back to pass, looking downfield. It is incomplete. The pass was intended downfield to Winslow at around the 40-yard line. The pass was behind him and almost intercepted by a couple Carmel Greyhounds that time. So coming into punt for the Kingsmen will be number 50, Jim Barnett. This will be their third punt of the evening, and back deep for the Greyhounds this time is Spidell.
Spidell also a third and second string, kind of in that area on the full house formation. One of the better athletes for the Greyhounds.
So Barnett gets off a very good kick, a high one that will be fielded at the 25-yard line. Brings it up to the 40, the 45, right up the middle, into Penn territory inside the 50-yard line to the 49-yard line. So it'll be first and 10 for the Carmel Greyhounds on the 49-yard line. But there is a penalty flag on the play. We'll check to see what that is.
That's going to be a blocking penalty of some form or another. It's going to be a clip against Carmel. So 15 yards takes it back to Greyhounds. Not fortunate on the penalty side of the ball game. That's going to bring up now first and 10 from or be near the 30-yard line for Carmel. Or excuse me, about the 36. So a penalty hurting the Greyhounds. So right now, our score is 7-6 in a very heated battle. Right now, Cap, it's been hard to say who's winning the ball game. Coach Belden said, you know, that inch of real estate where the ball is going to sit is going to determine this ball game. It's been pretty even so far, I think.
So Padgett for the grounds is back in the ballgame. Post set behind him. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Two men out wide, left and right. Padgett drops back pass, looking downfield. Pump fake, now looking deep down the right side. Intended receiver is Harrington. It is incomplete. Harrington made a diving catch. It looked like he hauled it in, but his feet were not in bounds. That was one heck of an effort that time by Harrington. He just gave his all effort, spreading himself at around the 30-yard line. Could not quite keep his feet in bounds. One heck of an effort that time by Harrington. So it'll be second down and 10 for the Carmel Greyhounds. Hansman checking in the ball game for the Greyhounds.
Watch maybe, Cap, if the Greyhounds continue to go up there in the air, watch for a little bit of shorter passes, like maybe even to the running backs for the Hounds.
So two men split out wide to the left. Those are Taylor and Hansman. Now Hansman in motion to the right. Padgett drops back to pass, looking downfield, rolling to his right. Pass is incomplete, intended for Ritz at the 45-yard line. Ritz, the senior tight end, already has one touchdown reception in the ballgame. That is eighth on the year. So it'll be third down and 10 for the Greyhounds. Another big down for the Greyhounds on the about the 31-yard line. Penn Kingsman trying to hold on here. They want the ball another time in this half. Gunderson checks in the ballgame, bringing in the signs for Padgett.
Kep, we might see a run play, possibly the draw that Mike Sharp runs so well.
So Padgett over center, the I formation behind him. Now he's dropping back in the shotgun formation. Two men out wide left, one man out wide right. The one man out wide right is Ritz. It's the shovel pass right inside to Sharp. He's at the 35, the 40. First down over midfield to the 49-yard line. Great call that time from the Greyhounds. Padgett was in the shotgun formation. The snap was made, and just a little shovel pass inside to Sharp. He was held at a round line of scrimmage and then broke it for the first down. Great play that time for the Greyhounds. A big pickup for the Greyhounds of about 19 yards on the play.
Well, Kep, I had the right play, actually, instead of a draw, it was a delay play. The shovel pass went to Sharp for the 19-yard pickup.
So Padgett over center, first and 10 inside Penn territory. I formation behind him. Cole and Sharp are the running backs, zooming out wide left and right. Padgett drops back to pass, looking down the right side. It is complete to Hansman at the 30-yard line, out of bounds at the 26-yard line. The Greyhounds are really pushing it. Penalty flag on the play. That will be defensive roughness on the play. Hansman was pushed out of bounds and then dragged down when he was out of bounds. So that will be another 15 yards against the Penn Kingsman.
A late hit is what the call is going to be, a personal foul. The Greyhounds now getting breaks. Cap, it's kind of hard to say now that they aren't going to move a big one here, because it's going to be a 22-yard pass reception to Hansman, plus the penalty of 15 yards. So the Greyhounds move it excellent. And so it was Penn for the Greyhounds. Now Carmel's in the red zone, so they like to say. Inside that 20-yard line, Carmel this year has been unstoppable, as most years, running out of the running out of the full house formation, which the Greyhounds do bring up. But the Greyhounds have been unsuccessful in the run. We could even see them continue to pass the ball.
Greyhounds showing the power eye formation. Moore, Sharp, and Cole are the running backs. Two tight ends in the ball game. Padgett drops back to pass, looking in the end zone. It is complete for a touchdown. Adam Ritz in the end zone. 13-yard pass completion for a touchdown. Bill Padgett to Adam Ritz. Ritz picks up his second touchdown of the ball game, and the Greyhounds go on top by a score of 12-7. Adam Ritz picks up his second touchdown reception. Greyhounds on top for the first time in the ball game, and now they will attempt the extra point, but there is a timeout on the field. The Greyhounds will want to think over if they want to go for two here, which they might, because the original point after attempt was no good.
Well, Bill Padgett stays on the field. They're going to go for two. Now it's just how and what play they're going to use. That touchdown drive, six plays, 69 yards. Remember, they went incomplete pass real quick, a delay to Sharp. He ran it 19 yards, and then a 22-yard pass to Hansman, then a 15-yard penalty, then a 13-yard touchdown. You know, Cap, jokingly, Adam Ritz said to me today, I walked by him, I go, touchdown, Adam Ritz. He said, about later on in the game, you're going to look up and you're going to say, oh my gosh, he's in the end zone again for the third time this evening. Well, now he's already got two in the first half. So Adam Ritz kind of he's kind of proud of his flakiness, actually. One of the senior on this football team, also the senior class president, a real flake on the football team, but he really puts together a good football performance. I'm sure the coaches so far tonight can't think of anything else, and I don't think I'd be too upset to see him get that extra, the next touchdown, as he's going to say three times. He called it last time. He said, "I was going to say touchdown, Greyhounds," by Adam Ritz. So Ritz kind of, I think, maybe get the inside track. Maybe we can bring him up here for the next game if the Greyhounds make it that far. Score 12-7. A little bit of time left in the first half. We're not exactly sure. Our scoreboard clock is not running. Now, I'll tell you, Cap, the Greyhounds doing this, this has taken away a lot from the pen and the emotion of the ball game. That's what Coach Belton said is the key, is emotion, how up you are, what kind of level you stay on. That's taken a lot out of Penn sales. If Carmel can convert the two-point conversion, that is definitely going to take a lot out of the sales of Penn. But, you know, an explosive team like Penn, they're running in the state and 16th in the country. Playing a team like this, it's not over till it's over.
Two tight ends, full house formation for the Greyhounds. Cole Sharp and Moore are the running backs. Two-point conversion here for the Greyhounds. Padgett barks out the signals. Now he calls a timeout. He did not like what he was seeing in the defense. Or also, the Penn band was being extremely loud, along with the Penn fans. He might not have been able to call out his signals. So they do call a timeout. That is their third timeout in the half. So now Coach Jim Belton will once again come on the field to talk things over with quarterback, senior quarterback for the Greyhounds, Bill Padgett.
Padgett, who got his bell rung a little earlier, has really come back hard for the Greyhounds. Now, Carmel, on extra point attempts, they've gone for two now. This will be the third time. Mike Sharp is 1-for-1 in the passing category and 0-for-1 in the running category. If I recall right, I know the one that he converted, I believe, was against Noblesville. As we look through our stats here real quick, the one that the Greyhounds know, the conversion attempt was against North Central when Padgett hit Sharp, and then the Greyhounds missed one later on against Noblesville. So Carmel has been good and bad, so to speak, on the point after 50-50 out of two tries, both of them going to Mike Sharp. It wouldn't surprise me to see him go to Tom Moore, maybe somebody who they're not positive it's going to go to, maybe somebody they might not think of. Now, we see Penn, the bands, and some other people waving flags behind the Carmel Greyhound end zone.
Greyhounds come to the line of scrimmage. Now Padgett drops in the shotgun. Hansman and Taylor out wide right. Ritz out wide to the left. Big down, big play for the Greyhounds. Padgett on the shovel pass inside. That'll be point after attempt is good. The shovel pass was inside to Mike Sharp right inside. Once again, we see that shovel pass inside. So the Greyhounds now take that 14-7 lead, 7-point advantage on the 2-point conversion. Padgett to Sharp. This is turning out to be a great ball game. Greyhounds really having a lot of momentum here late in the second quarter.
So Carmel converts the extra point after missing the last one, actually extra points, so to speak. Now Penn needs to start things off with a good drive. We're sure there's only just a few minutes left to go here in this first half. We'll have to wait and see. We're asking around for the time. We don't know. Right now we see Matt Elliott to set the kicking crew of the Greyhounds. Mark Lavatt, who's put one, actually his last kick was fielded at about the 10, his first one he knocked in the end zone. And we see Lavatt adjusting the ball, setting it a little more upright. Cap, we possibly could see an onside kick now if the Greyhounds are willing to chance it, if there's not much time on the clock.
Lavatt gets a good one off. This one will be fielded at the 15-yard line. He's up to the 20, the 25-yard line, hit there, and he's still going around the right side. He's to the 30-yard line, knocked out of bounds at around the 31-yard line. Kaufman, the return man that time, he took it inside and was hit there, stayed on his feet, broke it to the outside, so he gives his team good field position on the 30-yard line. So it'll be first and 10 for the Penn Kingsmen on the 30-yard line. Greyhounds have really got to dig in here and hold the momentum.
Watch Penn to come out and pass. Again, late in the first half, they don't want to be down going into the locker room by no doubt.
So Carlton sets up over center, the split formation behind him. Winslow and Hogg are the running backs. One man out, wide to the right. Carlton hands the ball off right up the middle to Hogg, and Hogg is dropped for maybe a yard on the play. The entire Greyhound line right in there to make the stop. Greyhound's line is playing excellent football right now, making a lot of big stops, not letting Penn get those big yardage. That was a pickup of about one on the play. So it'll be second down and 9 for the Penn Kingsmen. Carlton once again takes him to the line. 2 minutes remaining in the half now. Hogg and Kaufman are the running backs behind Carlton in the split formation. One man out wide to the right. Carlton drops back to pass, looking downfield, releases a long one. That is incomplete at the 30-yard line, just overthrew Mark Sampson. He was all alone. He had beaten Mark Lovott by about two steps. The pass was incomplete at around the 25-yard line, just overthrew Mark Sampson. So it'll be third down and a big nine yards for the Penn Kingsmen as they bring it to the huddle. Cromwell Graham's trying to dig in, about a minute and a half left to go in the first half. Carlton over center. Hogg and Winslow are the running backs behind him in the split formation. One man out wide to the right. Carlton drops back to pass, getting good protection. Now unleashes it. It is incomplete. Pass was intended that time for number 88, Matt Milestrup, one of the tight end and split ends for the Penn Kingsmen. So it'll be fourth down and 9 yards to go for the first down.
Carter with about a minute and a half now. We see John Spidell, who really started things off. The Carmel fans finally coming alive. We see a section of student bodies to the right of us that's big. A smaller section to the left looks to be maybe junior high kids. But there are a lot of people here at Carmel High School. They expected 5,500 and kept it. Doesn't look like we're very short of that tonight.
So Burnett steps back on his own 20-yard line to punt the ball away. Spidell awaits the punt. This is a high kick, but not very long. It will drop at the 40-yard line. Spidell does not want to touch. It bounces out of bounds at the 34-yard line of the Carmel Grounds. So the entire Carmel Grounds offensive line comes onto the field. It'll be first and 10 for the Carmel Grounds at around the 34-yard line. Carmel Grounds should be coming out passing here, trying to get some more points on the board, or they might just settle down and run the clock out because they do have the kickoff in the second half.
Kep, you might see them pass long, and I'll tell you why. If you do pass long and there's an interception, you're possibly going to stop them short and give them awful field position. But I don't know if Coach Belden's going to decide to let that chance go.
Greyhounds come to the line of scrimmage, I formation behind Padgett. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Padgett gives the ball off to Sharp right up the middle. He gains about a yard on the play. It'll be second down and 9 for the first down. Carmel Greyhounds now facing a second down and 9 situation here. They're on around the 37-yard line. Second and 9. Carmel Greyhounds on top, 14-7, and a great ball game here from Carmel High School. About a minute 15 left to go in the ball game, in the first half, rather. King leads him to the line of scrimmage. Padgett sets up over center. Two men out wide, left and right. Taylor and Hansman are his receivers. I formation behind Padgett. The pitch back around the right side to Sharp. He is over the 40-yard line to about the 40-yard line. Pickup of about 3, maybe 4 yards on the play. It'll be third down and 5 for the Penn Kingsmen.
Mike Sharp now with 8 carries in the ball game. Toby Cole, believe it or not, only has 3 carries in the ball game for 3 yards. Sharp has busted loose for 34 yards, been stopped twice for no gains, but he's really helped out with a big 19-yard run in the last possession. And now they're saying that's the end of the first half. That is the end of the first half, so the Greyhounds take to the locker room on top, 14-7. Over Penn, who just happens to be ranked number 1 in the state and number 16th in the nation. And now we see both teams as they kind of intermix going into the locker room. This has been a game full of a lot of emotion now. Both teams with a very big rest. Tell you, Kep, we're going to go back to the station now for this 60-second booster timeout and then come back with an interview from Sports Edge last night with Coach Sharon Rosenberg of the girls' basketball team as they get ready for the basketball season. So we'll have that up for you after this timeout. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhound.
Ahead Banking, a package of financial services and sound advice, only at Indiana National.
And digital sounds of Carmel. Large selection of digital compact disc players and has over 5,000 CDs in stock. Digital Sounds is located at the corner of 116th Street, Rangeline Road, right next to Osco Drugs. For more information, call Mike Santemeyer at 846-3734. That's 846-3734, Digital Sounds. WHJE would like to thank these boosters for their generous contributions.
Welcome back to Sports Edge. Our host now joining us, our guest is Coach Sherry Rosenberg of the girls basketball team. How are you doing today, Mr. Rosenberg?
Fine. Glad to be here.
Things are getting cleaned up and it's time for basketball season. Pretty good season for the girls last year. As you look back now, what was last season to you?
Well, last season was a very successful season in breaking 16 school records and tying several others. We had a nice balanced group of veterans, but yet young people that are back with us again this year. We did graduate to our inside people, Kristen Desco, who's now at the University of Florida, and Jody Vaughn, who's a walk-on and playing at Purdue University with our height and power play inside, and along with those two and then all the other players that are returning this year, we had a good season last year in 16-5 and lost three times to our county rival, Noblesville, who, of course, is state champions. And our other two losses coming to a number three ranked team, Greenfield Central. We lost to them by 1 point. And then we also lost to number four ranked Brebeuf by 6 points during the season. So we play a very competitive schedule and felt with that we ended up with a nice season. It's been nice, of course, to win them all, and who doesn't want to win them all, but 16-5 was a very respectable performance from Carmel High School.
You don't necessarily have the size coming back this year from what you had last year, but it seems like this team could be a lot quicker. What are your thoughts on this year's team overall?
Well, as far as your height goes in measurement, 6'1 and 6'0 graduating, that's probably above average for a girls' team and have that kind of play inside. And we are 5'10 and 6'0 this year with some height inside from Susan Grimmel and Bronnen and DeWitt. Junior playing for us. So it depends on how you play, and it also depends on how big you play. So I still think we're very average with our height, but we will be quicker overall. This year it appears as if Kathy Miller and Emily McCracken, of course, will be our, as they have been the last 2 years, our regular guards. We've gotten a lot of play and help defensively and offensively from Wendy Castor, who's the same size as Kathy and Emily, and we pull her in for a three-guard offense or play one of the three underneath. So we're looking for her to be a starting role, which is going to add overall quickness from those three people. And then Susan Grimmel, who may have played middle on our press and a little slower, her job is to work the ball inside, and but compensates for not being as quick as the others. She'll be back underneath the basket for us, and that allows us to put Wendy Logan, who's very quick and a keeper for the soccer team, the state runner-up team, very quick and very agile, lets her play the middle versus where Susan Grimmel played the middle on the press last year. Or even Tom Ray, who's also a keeper for the soccer team, very quick and good athlete and strong, and adds a lot of quickness to the front part of our press, as well as the ball handling and defensively. So that speed can compensate a lot for the few inches that we played, and those 5'6", 5'7", girls play real big anyway.
Probably one of the more talented girls' backcourts in the state, Kathy and Emily. As you mentioned, this is their third year as starters. They've been excellent ball players for you. What kind of leadership does that bring in?
Well, it's so apparent in practices that 2 years ago when they were sophomore, learning our system and understanding the system and getting through the system, as well as working on fundamentals and our gameplay. And this year they were ready to go the first night. And we still, as a high school program would be, we have to teach the system and work on the fundamentals and all with the younger people as well. And you always work on your fundamentals. But they're ready to go on and to add depth to their own skills and their own game within our system. And they're doing a great job and consequently understanding the system and being seniors. They find the openings much easier. They know what to expect from their teammates and each other. And so they're being very efficient and very effective for us. And you did point out that they are two of the best guards in the state as a team together, have to be at least considered one of the best combinations in the state, and it's very apparent when they play. So their leadership and their experience makes our team very rich along those lines, and Grimmel inside, the same thing with her. And then, of course, Wendy Castor has averaged around 20 minutes a game last year, so she's rich with that kind of experience. So we have four strong veterans coming back.
Now, a coach at Carmel High School, a football coach, a few years back said, you know, to make a great team, you have to have great athletes. And it seems that this team has a lot of kids that are active in other sports. You mentioned the two girls playing soccer, plus you have quite a few playing volleyball. What role does that make, you know, does that bring them in better shape when they come in for the winter season and they're just ready to go physically? Does that really help?
Well, it depends on the sport, of course. Golf, we've had some golfers come over and they don't work on the cardiovascular system, so they're going to have to go through the same type of conditioning. Volleyball, some conditioning, a lot of flexibility, but we run a lot more than the volleyball team needs to or has to, so our conditioning program is much different. But the competitive edge and the tone for competition and the values that an athlete needs to have, yes, there's a very definite carryover. We've also had people come over from cross country, so obviously they're in good shape. But even within the game of basketball, you have to endure, but you have to have your sprint work, you have to have your flexibility, you have to have your footwork. So there is a carryover. Susan Grimmel's on the track team. I mentioned the two soccer people. Emily has been cross country in the past, also track. Kathy Miller does softball. Wendy Castor does softball and volleyball. So Tom Ray does soccer. So there's a lot of carryover there, and the girls are active and work hard in athletics all year long.
Looking at that first part of the season now, what are you expecting? What do you want from your hands?
Well, I told them last night we've got some rough edges, but we're primarily ready for November 19th, which is when we open. We are not ready for February 3rd or whenever the sectional is, or we aren't ready for the Olympic Conference, but we don't need to be ready right now. So what we hope to do is grab from each of our 16 games, and of course preseason being 8 or 9 games, as much as we can that will make us ready and more prepared mentally and physically for the events that go on in January. Girls' seasons play as many games as the boys do, and our season is a month shorter. So it shows the great demand that is placed on these girl athletes as well as students, being an entire month shorter than the boys' season, yet the same number of games.
Good luck as the season kicks off.
Thanks. Appreciate that.
Okay. Parts, but both the boys and the girls' season. Your season starts off a little earlier than the boys, about a week, goes to the Christmas break. Then you have a part off, and the second part of the season is really getting keyed up for sectionals. Matter of fact, you have two tournaments, one right after Christmas break, and then the Olympic Conference tournament, then the sectional. Looking at that first part of the season now,
What are you expecting? What do you want from your hands?
For their generous contributions.
Welcome back to Carmel High School, Yancey Deering and Kep Carmichael, bringing you tonight's ball game, definitely the closest and most exciting football game that we've seen so far this year. To highlight a few things, is the Greyhounds, if they've not played their traditional football game, we do have to say that, statistically wise, that is. Looking at some quick stats for the Greyhounds, Mike Sharp, 34 yards rushing with 8 yards in the, or carried it for 8 times. Bill Padgett now has 25 yards off 4 carries. Now, Toby Cole has only carried the ball 3 times and for 3 yards. In the receiving category, the Greyhounds are nothing short of awesome, so to speak. Adam Ritz has caught the ball 3 times. 2 of them for touchdowns. Ritz's first pass was a 14-yarder, then he had a 12-yard touchdown pass, and then a 13-yard touchdown pass. So he has 39 yards in the air and 12 points. And Jason Hansman, the only other Greyhound to have caught a pass, as a 22-yarder for Hansman. So Carmel now has really kind of mixed things up. It's almost been a 50-50 ball club. Looking at statistics for the Bend Kingsmen, they're being led by on the field by running by number 33, Mike Winslow, 13 yards on 7 carries. Then junior Dan Kaufman has 1 carry and 3 yards. And sophomore Steve Hogue has 10 yards off of 5 carries, and in the air, Ben has not been bad. I'll tell you what, Jeff, their quarterback has a pretty good arm. Kind of surprised me. I do have a 41-yard pass, if you remember, a little earlier in the ball game, which set up their first touchdown. Our score now, 14-7. We've had a heck of a way to get there, though. Carmel scored first on Adam's first touchdown pass, and then the extra point attempt was missed by Mark Lavat. Then Carmel comes back and scores again after some excellent defensive play, and then they go for two, give a delay play, a shuttle pass to Mike Sharp, and Carmel got a 2-point conversion, and that now the Greyhounds are on top of a 14-7 total here at halftime from Carmel High School. Kep, do you have some team statistics for us?
So far for the Penn Kingsmen, they have picked up 35 yards on the ground, and Carlton in the air is two of six attempts for 41 yards. He has had 1 pass intercepted. The Kingsmen have punted the ball away 3 times and have fumbled once and lost that fumble. And they have been penalized for 13 yards. That a unnecessary roughness call against the defense. The Carmel Greyhounds have 38 yards on the ground. Bill Padgett is a really good stat right here. He is 5 of 8 in the air for 86 yards. 3 of those receptions going to the senior tight end, Adam Ritz. Padgett has been intercepted once. They have fumbled the ball once. That ball was lost. They have punted the ball away twice, and they have been penalized for 20 yards. Recapping the scoring in the ball game, the Penn Kingsmen got on the scoreboard first with about 2 minutes left to go in the first quarter. It capped a four-play, 47-yard drive. Kaufman ran it in from 3 yards out. The point after attempt was good, and the score was 7-0 in favor of the Penn Kingsmen. Carmel Greyhounds got on the scoreboard first in the second quarter. Padgett hit Adam Ritz on a 12-yard touchdown pass. The point after attempt was no good by Lavotte, and the Greyhounds was still down by a 7-6 margin. Then later in the second quarter, Padgett hit Ritz one more time, this one from 13 yards out for the touchdown pass, capping a six-play, 69-yard drive. The two-point conversion was good. Padgett with a shovel pass to Sharp, and the Greyhounds were on top for the first time in the ballgame, 7-14.
So now Carmel has held on to that seven-point lead. We see now Penn rushing through a tunnel made by the band, by the Kingsmen band who performed for us at halftime. Pretty good band show. Not the band connoisseur that I am, but of the bands that we've seen this year, they definitely appeared to be a top-notch band. Watch for Toby Cole possibly to get a few more yards. That really is a surprising statistic up here in the press box, being mentioned by a lot of people. It's good to see Tony Mefford. We mentioned he's back running. He appears to be okay. We've seen him in and out during the full game. But I'll tell you, Cap, the key in this ball game has to be the Greyhound offensive and defensive line. Now, that offensive line, by the way, was the answer to last night's trivia question on Sports Edge. Cap, you want to set that front line for us once again?
Come on, front line, of course. On left tackle, big number 74, junior John Hebert. At left guard, Greg Bowen. Center, Todd King. Mark Towner, senior, number 65, at right guard. And at right tackle, Jim Pesek, number 56. A great front line, interior lineman for the Greyhounds, as they've been all year long.
The defensive line has also done a tremendous job this evening. Cap, do you want to give us the starting lineups for the Greyhound defensive line?
Defensive line anchoring him on the left end, David Kennedy, one of the all-suburban first-team members from the Carmel Greyhounds. He's at the left end. Rick Atkins at left tackle. Todd Green at nose tackle. Drew McDonald on the right tackle. And at the other defensive end, Josh Malinchuk, another member of the first-team all-suburban team from the Carmel Greyhounds, is linebacker Trent Decatur. Quite a few other Carmel Greyhound players made the honorable mention. Jim Pesek made that team from the interior front line for the Greyhounds. Bill Padgett, Toby Cole, Pete Harrington, Mark Lavotte, and Tom Moore made it. Adam Ritz made the honorable mention. So a lot of Greyhounds getting in there in the all-suburban team.
Also, watch for Padgett possibly to be all-conference. He was all-conference last year and all-county. So now the awards come in. And, you know, Coach Belden last evening on Sports Edge said, you know, it's great to have awards, but we really try to make things, you know, kids say, you know, it's only good to get an award like that if you accomplished your team goal to do it. Now the Greyhounds really fired up. They will receive. We see a meet on the field. And, Cap, this has to be the most emotion we've seen them. I'll tell you what, right now I'm glad I'm not playing on either team because both teams are so fired up. We're going to see somebody hurt here before too long, because I tell you what, this game has had a lot of emotion. We've got a packed house on Penn side. They're sitting in the aisles. Carmel fans, there are no aisles. Basically, from what we can tell, a lot of people standing. Both bands are here. People sitting up on top of the ambulance across the way. That's part of Penn's band. I mean, there's just a bunch of people here. This might be a record crowd. They said 5,500 is what they expected. Now, we've been told that Carmel's fans hold roughly 5,000 people. Nobody really knows, but there's that. And then there's a land called Teenage Wasteland capacity crowd here at Carmel High School.
Burnett gets the opening kickoff. Herman fields it at the 5-yard line, up to the 20, the 25-yard line, breaks it to the 30, the 35, dropped at the 36, 37-yard line. There is a penalty flag on the play.
Now that flag thrown, where it's thrown, will be an illegal block of some form.
appears that they might be talking to Penn, so it's going to go against the Greyhounds. That's the second time this evening that we've seen Carmel whistled for an illegal block, if that does go against Carmel. And they are walking back, so the flag is thrown at the 20. And then they're going to walk back from the flag, moving the ball to the 10-yard line. So about a 10-yard penalty from where the flag was thrown. Cap, I got to think that was a holding call. And it does go against Carmel. So now Carmel, I think we're going to see Carmel come out and try to control the game a little bit more. Watch them to pass on first down a lot more, but I think they're going to try to establish a little more of a running game to beat this Penn team.
Ground show the split formation with Colin Sharp, two tight ends and one flanker back. That's Gunnarsson split wide to the right. Handoff right up the middle. Cole getting the call. He gets just a couple yards. He's up to around the 14-yard line. A good pickup of about 3 yards on the play. So Toby Cole picks up 3 yards on the game. Toby Cole has had limited action so far in the ball game. We expect to see him getting the ball a lot more here in the second half. King leads him out of the huddle. Padgett will set up over center King. The split formation. Now showing the T formation with two tight ends. Moore, Sharp, and Cole are the running backs. Getting the handoff is Cole, and he is dropped over the 15-yard line. He has dropped at the 15-yard line for a gain of about 2 yards on the play. So it'll be third down and 5 for the Greyhounds on the 15-yard line.
We see now the Penn fans have quieted down. So is the team. They're looking a little more straight-faced on that sideline. Carmel's also a lot that same way. I think right now at the beginning of the second half, the score 14-7 is so close, and the whole ball game, every aspect's been close. Now faces start to get a little shaky. Now's when you got to not let an error happen on your side.
I formation behind Padgett. Colin Sharp are the running backs. Padgett hands it off to Sharp around the left side. He's up to the 20-yard line, over the 20-yard line to about the 22-yard line. That should be a first down where they are marking. They're marking it around the 21-yard line, and that will be a first down for the Carmel Greyhounds. So they pick up their first down here in the second half after a 6-yard pickup by Mike Sharp. Gunnarsson checks into the ballgame, bringing in the play to Bill Padgett. They could possibly start going to the air here with the ball on the 22-yard line of the Carmel Greyhounds out of their own territory. Two tight ends still with a split formation behind Padgett. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Gunnarsson split wide to the left. Cole gets the call right up the middle, getting good yardage, picking up about 4 yards on the carry. It'll be second down and 6 for the Greyhounds. Checking out for the Greyhounds is Gunnarsson, and checking in is Hansman and Taylor.
Cap, the Greyhound offensive line is really exploding off the ball well, and that's why Toby's really breaking open. He does a good job at finding holes, and they really have a lot of confidence in each other between Toby and the front line. And that's why Toby's now, we see all the running backs actually will start picking up a little more yardage now.
Hansman and Taylor split wide to the right. Pro set behind Padgett, Cole, and Sharp. Cole gets the call right over the middle once again. He has enough yardage for the first down. He's up to the 40-yard line, carrying three tacklers with him up to the 42-yard line. 41-yard, rather. That is Toby Cole. He is picking up more yards. That's good enough for a first down. Carmel Greyhounds are really driving right down the field. Hansman and Taylor check out as Harrington checks back in.
So Toby now on that gain of 14 yards with 27 yards in the ball game off of 7 carries. He's carried the ball every time but once, and that was off a Mike Sharp carry. So the Greyhounds now really going to Toby a lot in this second half.
Greyhounds show the I formation now splitting to the pro set, sending Tooman out wide to the right. Padgett running the option play, and it is Sharp getting the carry, rather Cole getting the carry, and he's dropped for a loss that time at the 35-yard line. Big loss of about 7 yards on the play. Cole couldn't get around the corner. A lot of Penn Kingsmen in there to make the stop. That could be a play that Penn needed to get their defense fired up. So Taylor checks back into the ball game. Padgett getting the signals in. Now Hansman checks back in. He's bringing in the play for the Greyhounds. Big second down and a very long play of about 15 yards for the Greyhounds. Coming to the line first is King. Padgett sets over him. I formation behind him. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Taylor is split wide to the right. Hansman wide to the left. Pass over the middle is incomplete off the fingertips of Ritz at the 50-yard line. It was just a little bit high. Ritz tried to control it. He couldn't quite control it. Dropped incomplete.
Padgett that time throwing a bullet right up the middle. looking more like a car commercial I saw the other day with a bullet, but that was definitely a bullet thrown by Bill Padgett, as he really let that one go. Ritz didn't even, wasn't even expecting it that quick. I was really surprised that Padgett went up. Looked like he had a little more time than what he did, but then we saw Penn start to come in. Now big third down. Watch for Padgett to slip into the shotgun formation.
Third and 15 for the Grounds. Two men out wide to the left. Ritz is out wide to the right. Pro set behind Padgett. Running the draw play to Sharp, and he won't get anywhere. Dropped at the line of scrimmage for no gain, possibly a loss of about a foot. So it'll be fourth down for the Greyhounds. And in comes Chris Rasmussen to attempt his first punt of this, the second half. Greyhounds on top in the ballgame, 14-7.
Tell you what, Cap, the Greyhounds might have lost 6 yards on that from the first down, but I tell you, actually, they moved the ball well. If you remember, this drive started inside their own 10-yard line. They moved it well. If you take away one play, the Greyhounds have moved the ball real well. That really helps confidence.
Rasmussen gets a shanked punt off the right. That will land out of bounds at around the 50-yard line. So the Penn Kingsmen will take over first and 10 on the 50-yard line. The Greyhound defense has really got to tighten up here. They can't give Penn anything on their first possession.
So now Penn will start from about the Greyhound 46. What they do that time on that play, Cap, is they see where supposedly it crosses the line. Now, I think it'd be kind of hard to do just by eye of sight, but that does give them the ball on the 46-yard line.
Conley Carlton sets up over center, one man out wide to the right, pro set behind him, getting the call right up the middle. That is Kaufman. He gets a good 6 yards on the carry up to the 40-yard line. So it'll be second down. Rather, he gets about 5 yards on the play. It'll be second and five for the Penn Kingsmen. So they break huddle, bringing it out of the huddle first is Pritz, the center. Now Carlton sets up over him, the split formation behind him, one man out wide to the right, two tight ends in the ballgame. Carlton barks out the singles left and right, second and six. Handoff goes right up the middle that time to Winslow. He has enough for the first down over the 35 to about the 30-yard line. Good carry that time for the first down. Winslow getting a lot of action here in the ballgame. It'll be first and 10 on the 33-yard line of the Carmel Greyhounds. Carmel defense has really got to dig in here, getting the singles from the sidelines. Breaking huddle is the Penn Kingsmen. Split formation behind Connolly. Connolly barks out the signals left and right. One man out wide to the right, two tight ends in the ballgame. Carlton barks the signals, and there's a penalty flag on the play. It looks as if Josh Malinchuk might have jumped offside that time. We'll wait and see the penalty. The referee is coming in to talk things over here.
Josh, for the Greyhounds, definitely a good example of a student athlete, also in the ambassadors. That time got a little called off the front line. A little bit of jumpy, both teams are. That now brings up first down and five for Penn.
So the 5-yard penalty is assessed. First and five for the Penn Kingsmen on the 27-yard line. Split formation behind Connolly, one man out wide to the right, a flanker back out to the left. Carlton hands the ball off right up the middle. He is dropped for no gain. In on the carry that time, Brian Shellstraight. That time for a short carry to around the 26-yard line of the Carmel Greyhounds. A short gain of about 1 yard on the play. So it'll be second down and four for the Penn Kingsmen.
Big down here for the Greyhounds. Now if they can stop, Penn on this play and stop them next play, then you force, then you make them to come out of their game a little bit. So that's what Cardinals trying to do at this point.
Shellstraight and Winslow in the pro set behind Carlton, moving in motion to the right is one of the flanker backs. Hands off, rather the option play, and Carlton's going to keep it. He is not going to, he will be close to the first down, rather. He's inside the 25 to around the 23.5-yard line. It'll be close to the first down, but will not be close enough. It'll be third and about one. There is an official timeout on the field.
Now, Cap, we've mentioned a few times this evening about the clock. We don't have a scoreboard clock that is running right now. They're going to measure for the first down. That's what the timeout is. It is that close. Now, the back judge on the field is keeping the score. Now, Penn's going to be short, by the way, on the first down by about a yard. But as we were saying, the back judge will be keeping the time. So we can't get any times until the referee tells a Carmel coach who wires it upstairs, and then it comes downstairs to the press box and we find it. So after everybody's heard it, we're the last people to hear it. So we're going to do our best to get you the times, though.
So a big third down play, 7-14 our score. Carmel Grounds on top in the third quarter. T formation and two tight ends in for the Penn Kingsmen. Definite running play here, third and short. Carlton sets up over center, three backs in the backfield. Handoff goes right up the middle to Winslow. He might have been stopped short of the first down. A lot of Greyhounds in there, along with David Kennedy was Rick Atkins, a lot making the stop there. They're going to spot the ball right around the 23 and a half, maybe 24 yard line.
The Greyhounds are saying they stopped him. They're going to measure once again. But I tell you, Carmel's celebrating on their side. Now the Greyhounds really need to stop the
5 minutes remaining.
They need to stop Penn here unofficially now. They've just announced over the PA system, you might have heard it, 5 minutes left to go in the third quarter. So time has run out. This has been a very consuming third quarter. They're saying Penn picked up the first down. So Penn, after the officials call first down, Penn gets it. We see Brian Vaughn now check in for Drew McDonald. That brings in a third linebacker, so you could see the Greyhounds speed up, try to use a tornado defense. They need to make a stop or a turnover. They need to do something for a loss of yards here.
First and 10 on the 23-yard line. Carlton sets up over center. 2 men in the backfield in the pro set. 1 man split wide to the right. 2 tight ends in the ball game. Handoff goes around the left side to Hogg, rather. He's inside the 15 to around the 14-yard line. He will be close to another first down. It will be second down and about a yard on an 8-yard, 9-yard carry that time for Hogg. So it'll be second down, 1 yard to go for the first down. Carlton brings him in the line of scrimmage. Winslow and Hogg are the running backs in the split formation. 1 man out wide to the right. That is Cincilio. Carlton steps up over center, barks out the signals. Hand off to Winslow around the right side. It looks like he got the first down. He's down close to the 10-yard, around the 11-yard line.
Good misdirection play that time by the Penn Kingsmen. We see Coach Belden now pulls his offensive troops together. 4 receivers, 2 running backs, 2 tight ends, and about 5 linemen along with Padgett. They're going to talk things over. They're going to say, guys, you know, no matter what happens, we definitely need to keep points going. First and 10 now for Penn from about the 16-yard line.
Carlton sets up over center. Hogg now moves in motion to the right. Winslow is the remaining running back. He gets the ball right over the middle, and he is dropped for no gain on the play that time. Dropped at the 11-yard line. It'll be second and 10 for the Penn Kingsmen. 14-7 our score. Carmel Grounds on top. About 4 minutes left to go in the third quarter. Greyhounds getting a lot of points in the second quarter.
Winslow, the leading rusher for Penn. The Greyhounds have done a heck of a job stopping him. He's carried the ball 11 times, only for 22 yards. They've dropped him behind the line of scrimmage twice. So they've held him to about a 2-yard average.
Split formation behind Carlton. Winslow and Hogg are the running backs. 1 man out wide left, 2 men out wide to the left. Right to the right rather. Carlton barks out the signals. He drops back to pass, looking for the end zone. It is touchdown. That is a touchdown for the Penn Kingsmen. The referee over there wanted to make sure his feet were inbounds. They were a touchdown for the Penn Kingsmen. Carlton hits his receiver in the corner of the end zone for a touchdown, and Penn will attempt the point after attempt. Carmel Grounds still on top, 14-13, with the point after attempt to come.
Now they're saying there's about 2 minutes left to go here in the third period. This could tie up the score. Kind of scary. If Penn has enough confidence, we might see him go for 2. I don't think they would in this situation, though. They're down by a point. The Greyhounds looking to block this one. Last one, if you remember, was very low. The Hounds could have stopped it.
So Hainer attempts the extra point, and it is good. So it's tied score once again with 2 minutes left to go in the third quarter. The point after was good, 14-14 all. Number one ranked Penn Kingsmen come back, and they tie the score. Carmel Grounds had the lead 7-14. They marched the ball about 46 yards for the touchdown on a pass from Carlton to the receiver in the corner of the end zone.
So now the Hounds looking to make a big return here. They're going to send Harrington and Herman, Ron Herman, back deep to receive the up men, Tom Moore and Eric Gunderson. Now, last time the Greyhounds had the ball, they put together a good run off the ball off the kickoff, and then they had a problem with on a penalty flag, if you remember, a clipping call that hurt the Greyhounds.
So this a low kick will be fielded by Gunderson at the 15-yard line, up to the 20, to the 25, the 30, dropped right there, and struggles forward once again to the 30-yard line, and it was hit hard by Chris Bowling, moving down very quickly, was dragged back to the 25, then he lunged once again up to the 30-yard line, so the Greyhounds will take over first and 10 on the 30-yard line. Greyhound offensive unit coming on the field, trying to get some more points on the board. Score deadlocked here at Carmel High School, 14-all. Carmel Greyhounds first, the Penn Kingsmen.
Carmel's best music. You've got the edge. WHJE Carmel.
We're center. I formation behind him. Hansman and Harrington are split wide to the left. Hand off to Cole right over the left side. He's over the 35-yard line to about the 36. A 6-yard pickup by Cole that time. It'll be second down and 4.
Carmel's been a lot more successful in this half so far running, but I think they're going to go back upstairs, Kep. They really were very successful in the first half throwing, and I think they're going to try to get back on that game plan.
I formation behind Padgett, Cole and Sharp, the running backs. Two men are split wide to the right. Harrington and Gunderson are his running backs. One tight end, that's Ritz. Hand off to Cole right over the middle once again. He breaks it close to the 40-yard line, around the 39, a gain of about 3 yards on the play.
So Toby brings it very close to a first down. It will be third and about a foot and a half. So watch for Toby maybe to get the call once again. I don't think the Greyhounds are going to pass on this third down.
Third down and short for the Greyhounds. They've really got to do it here. Two tight ends, three backs in the backfield. Moore, Sharp, and Cole are the running backs. Ryan Herman and Ritz are the tight ends. Handoff goes to Cole right over the middle, and he has a first down and a lot more over the 45-yard line, dragging tacklers with him up to the 47-yard line. Cole with a big pickup there for the first down. Greyhounds on the 8-yard pickup by Cole. Greyhounds will take over, will have the ball first and 10 on the 47-yard line. 14-14 our score. Carmel Greyhounds and the Penn Kingsmen all tied up. Carmel Greyhounds trying to get some more points on the board here in the third quarter.
About a minute and a half left to go in this third quarter.
Padgett over center with the two tight ends and three backs. Moore, Sharp, and Cole remain in the ball game. Padgett barks out the signals left and right. Long count over center. Handoff goes to Cole once again, leaping over the line of scrimmage. He's into Penn territory around the 49-yard line, just inside the 50. A gain of about 3 yards on the play. It will be second down and 7.
Now, Toby so far in the second half has gotten every offensive call for the Greyhounds but four, an incomplete pass to runs by Mike Sharp and a punt. So Carmel definitely going to the senior fullback a lot.
Second and 7 just inside Penn territory. I formation behind Padgett, Cole, and Sharp, the running backs. One man out wide to the right, two tight ends. Padgett drops back to pass, looking downfield. Heavy pressure from behind. He gets the ball off, incomplete. Intended receiver was Cole. A lot of pressure put on by the safety blitz that time. Dave Kyle put some pressure on. Padgett spun him around. Padgett, thinking very wisely, got the ball off.
Penn wanting a grounding, but I'll tell you, he was just lucky to see Toby Cole sitting over there with nobody. Threw it hard enough to get it out of bounds, but kept a low one. Good thing that a streaking cornerback didn't come jump and get a hand on that one. Now third down and long. Watch for Padgett to drop back in the shotgun formation.
Big down here for the Greyhounds. Gunderson comes wide to the right. Harrington wide to the left. I formation with Cole and Sharp behind Padgett. Ritz is the tight end. Padgett drops back to pass, getting good protection over the middle. It is complete to Ritz at the 40-yard line, inside to the 39-yard line. Padgett to Ritz for a big completion there. That's for the first down. The Greyhounds now have 4 first downs here in the second half. A big completion to the 39-yard line of 11 yards that time from Padgett to Ritz. Good ball game here. Greyhounds and Penn all tied up at 14 apiece.
Bill Padgett is the leading yardsman for the Greyhounds. He has 50 yards off of four carries, two of them being touchdowns. So Adam Ritz, the big gainer. That's the end of our fourth quarter. Our third quarter, our score tied at a pair of 14s in the closest game of the season. If you remember, Carmel has not had a close game so far in the 1987 campaign. So that kind of even makes things a little more different. You try to hope that your team can hold on. They got to have faith in themselves that they can do it, and that is the key thing. Now it will be first and 10 for the Greyhounds in the Penn 39-yard line. We've got 12 minutes to go here. One final fourth quarter. The Greyhounds holding up four fingers, signaling this is their quarter, the fourth quarter, the quarter that the Greyhounds want. So the Greyhounds now definitely running a big fourth quarter. If you remember earlier, they were stuck by the second half jinx, but as of late, Cap, the last six games, the Greyhounds have killed the fourth quarter.
Padgett over center, the power eye formation, Moore, Sharp, and Cole are the running backs, two tight ends. Padgett drops back to pass, looking over the left side. It is complete to Sharp at the 25-yard line, knocked out of bounds at the 20-yard line. Padgett hitting Sharp out of the backfield for another Greyhound first down. The Greyhounds are really moving the ball now.
Kept the Greyhounds now put it in what you call the red zone. That's right now it stands on the 20-yard line. Anytime they get within that 20-yard line, you see it's just kind of elementary. Mark Towner limping off the field for the Greyhounds. Hopefully he's okay.
Greyhounds bring it to the line of scrimmage. Two tight ends, three backs in the T formation. Moore, Sharp, and Cole, the running backs. Ryan Herman and Ritz are the tight ends. Cole gets the call over the left side. He's inside the 15 to the 12-yard line. Fans really coming alive now.
So Toby Cole with about a 6-yard pickup on that play for Carmel as the Greyhounds are moving the ball awesomely now.
So Padgett gets the call in from the sidelines. It'll be second down and about 4 yards to go for the first down. Greyhounds inside the 15-yard line at the 13-yard line. Second down and about 3 for the first down. Greyhounds with two tight ends and the T formation. Sharp, Cole, Moore are the running backs. Padgett barks out the signs left and right. Cole gets the call over the left side. Once again, he's inside the 10 to about the 9.5-yard line for a short pickup on the play that time. So it will be good enough for the first down. Cole picks up the 4 yards he needed to get. So the Greyhounds will have it first and goal just inside the 10-yard line. They need basically all 10 yards to get the touchdown here on 4 downs. King leads him to the line of scrimmage. Padgett sets up over center. Greyhounds showing that two tight end T formation. Moore, Sharp, Cole are the running backs. Look for the Greyhounds maybe to go to the air this time. Padgett tries to roll out the option play. He's going to keep it. Lunges inside the 10-yard line for a short gain. He's to about the 8, maybe 9-yard line of Penn for a short gain of about 2 yards on the play.
So Bill Padgett now running very well for the Greyhounds. 28 yards for the senior quarterback. This is his third trip to the regional as a quarterback for Carmel High School. 28 yards rushing for him off of 5 carries. He's the Greyhounds' third leading rusher in this game.
So a big second down, 9 yards to go, two tight ends, three backs in the T formation. Moore, Sharp, Cole are the running backs. Padgett gives it off to Cole over the left side. That is touchdown, Greyhounds. Greyhounds pick up 6 more points on a 9-yard run from Toby Cole.
You hear the Carmel Greyhound fans as they go nuts here at Carmel High School. They just took the lead against the number one ranked Penn Giant or Kingsman in the state, number 16th in the nation. And now Carmel with the chicks to the extra point attempt. Here's Mark Lavatt on the field. Remember, he had a string of 27 straight broken last week.
Lavatt, it is blocked. The extra point is blocked. A lot of Kingsmen in there on the attempt. So that could be a big play down the last couple of minutes. So Lavon misses his second extra point here. So the score is 22-14, the Carmel Greyhounds on top of the Penn Kingsmen.
So Mark Lavatt misses his second of the game. He's missed 3 extra point attempts in the last 2 games. So his kicking could be down a little bit now, Carmel on top 20-14. Jeff, we said it was going to be a defensive battle for the Greyhounds, and now that's exactly what it's going to be. Carmel took that one 70 yards on roughly on 10 plays, so it was a 70 yards, 10 plays for the Greyhounds for the touchdown. So Carmel now needs to tighten up the defense, because with that block kick, that gives Penn an excellent chance. The Greyhounds now looking for a turnover of some sort.
So Levi will be set to kick off. Mike Delph, a senior leader for the ground, set to set the kicking team back deep for the Kingsmen, are Kaufman and Jordan. Levi set for his 5-yard run up on the kick. Greyhounds on top, 20-14. Lavat gets his foot into this one. This one is angled off to the left and will bounce at the 15 and go out of bounds at the 10-yard line. So that will be a penalty against the Carmel Greyhounds. We'll march them back 5 more yards. They will be kicking from the 35.
We'd like to welcome a new booster to WHJE Prestige Portraits, done by Life Touch Studios, a new WHJE booster. We'd like to welcome all our boosters. If you would like to be a booster, just send your donation to the Greyhound Booster Club here in Carmel. So definite thanks to all our boosters as the year has gone on. Kept, this is probably the best ball game we've seen all season, win or lose. 20-14 is the score. The Greyhounds on top. Mark Levitt now setting up at the 35-yard line for the Greyhounds to kick.
Fletcher and Kaufman back deep on their 10-yard line, set to return it. Levitt set to kick off. Levada's gotten a lot more distance later here in the season. Let's hope he gets a big kick here. They need it. Delph sets the kicking team, and Levitt gets a good high kick. This one will be fielded at the 16-yard line, rather the 11-yard line by Kaufman. He's up to the 25, the 30, over to the 35-yard line, dropped at the 37-yard line. Spidell with a big tackle that time for the Greyhounds.
So now Penn will take over and start. It will be first and 10 from their own 36-yard line. Kick of a return on that play, a 24-yarder, so the Kingsmen definitely doing a heck of a job on returning the balls off the touchdowns.
So Carlton sets up over center, the split formation behind him. One man out wide to the right, two tight ends. Grant showing tornado defense. Now they break it off as the handoff goes right up the middle for a two guards. Fumble on the play. First thing they'll say, Carmel, yes! Carmel football. Carmel recovers the fumble. On.
As you can hear the Carmel fans whistling through your radios at home, the Greyhounds have just recovered the third fumble of the ball game. The ball will be first and 10 at the 42-yard line.
Joe Kaufman picked up the fumble recover that time for the Carmel Greyhounds. Todd King set, will bring it to the line of scrimmage. Padgett sets up over center, the I formation behind him, sending Taylor and Hansman wide to the left. Now they're switching to the pro set with Sharp and Cole in the backfield. Cole gets the call over the left side, gets a few more yards over the 40-yard line to around the 37-yard line. Good run by Cole once again over the left side. A lot of offensive surge by that interior lineman of the Greyhounds we have been talking about all season long. Pesek, Bowen, Hebert, King, Towner, all in there doing a great job for the Greyhounds. So it'll be second down and about 7 yards to go after the 3-yard pickup by Cole. Padgett over center, the I formation behind him. Cole and Sharp are the running backs. Two men out wide to the left. Gunderson and Harrington are his wideouts. Ritz, the lone tight end. Cole gets the handoff, second man through. He gets a few more yards after the 35-yard line. So it will be after a gain of about 2 yards on the play. It'll set up a second down and 5 yards to go for the first down.
That's Mike Sharp's first carry of the fourth quarter. We have about 9 minutes, we've been told, unofficially here on the clock in the fourth quarter. If the Greyhounds can put together a score and a two-point conversion, it could be icing on the cake, Cap.
Padgett now calls a timeout when he brings in the line of scrimmage. That gives us time to take this 60-second booster timeout. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
Where do you go when you want more? You eat pizza for. Delicious toppings, incredible crust. Make no mistake, there's just one place that does. Go to the very end. Pizza King, Pizza King.
To the very end.
Pizza King Pizza is right next door. Call Pizza King in Carmel for your next pizza or stop by our restaurant at 902 South Rangeline Road. Call 848-7994 for our fast free delivery. Pizza King is open at 11 a.m. Monday through Friday for your lunchtime orders.
That makes us go to
That's 848-7994 for Pizza King Pizza. Carmel, Indiana, 46032.
Welcome back to Carmel High School. Yancey Darien and Kep Carmichael. Our score, 20-14. The Greyhounds on top of number one ranked Penn, number Carmel unranked. They said they know they're not in the top 15, so if you multiply that by 50, that's 750th. So Coach Belden feels that's about where a squad is. Penn is 16th in the nation. The Greyhounds, 750. This would be a heck of an upset, Cap. Third down and four for the Greyhounds. I formation behind Padgett. Colin Sharp, the running back. Two-man out wide, left and right. Padgett drops back to pass. Now rolling to his left, looking downfield. Complete to Ritz at the 17-yard line, inside the 15. He is still on his feet. Touchdown, Adam Ritz. Oh, my gosh. Adam Ritz is in the end zone for the third time tonight. Adam Ritz, touchdown Greyhounds. Ritz caught the ball on the 23-yard line, scampered in, tightroping it on the line for the touchdown Greyhounds.
The officials are talking to Bill Padgett. He might have been out of bounds.
No.
Yep, they're calling it at the 16-yard line. The Greyhound fans are very upset. The Penn Kingsman, on the other hand, pretty happy. Cap a little bit as he regains his composure. That's a good one on the third down of the possession from Ritz to Padgett. We said that's exactly what's going to happen. Watch for Ritz to get it. Now, Cap, who might explain that outburst here after the Greyhound stopped his possession? That was kind of a present to Adam Ritz. He said that's what we'd say. But anyway, he said he was going to get three touchdowns in tonight's ball game. He was almost pretty close there. He has two this evening. Now, the Greyhounds are set up at the 16-yard line. They're saying that Ritz was knocked out of bounds. It was awful close. It was hard to call from up here. The officials, of course, with the best view on the play. 20-14 is the score. Bill Padgett and his troops out on the field. Here comes Eric Gunderson checking in for the Greyhounds. They better be careful because they've been out there for quite a while. No penalties needed now.
So the Greyhounds bring it to the line of scrimmage. Split formation behind Padgett, Sharp, and Cole are the running backs. Gunderson and Harrington split wide to the left. Handoff right up the middle that time. Cole getting the carry. He's inside the 15 to about the 14.5-yard line for a gain of a 2-yard gain that time. So it'll be second down and 8 for the Greyhounds.
So Toby Cole blasts open for the Greyhounds. Connell so far has carried the ball four times this possession for 27 yards. You see Ryan Herman checking the ball game for the Greyhounds. So definitely the full house formation in right now.
So the Greyhounds showing the wishbone formation now. Cole, Sharp, and Moore are the running backs. Two tight ends in the ball game. Padgett running the option play. He's going to keep it. Turns it upfield. He's to the 5-yard line. Padgett turns it inside with a good blocking up front to the 5-yard line. Good carry on the play that time. That will be close to a first down, short of it by about 2 yards. It'll be third down and about 2.
So Carmel with that one, about a 6-yard pickup on the play. Bill Padgett, now they're saying they're going to bring the chains out. They're saying it's a lot closer than that. This also buys the time for the coaches to consider what they feel is going to be going on, what plays they might want to call. Kept it still very close to first down. First down, Greyhounds. Carmel picks up the first down off of the Bill Padgett 8-yard run. So Carmel picks up the first down as Bill Padgett signals it first to the coaches with a clenched fist. Now it's first down from about the 7-yard line.
First and goal to go for the Greyhounds inside the 10 at the 7. Two tight ends, full house formation. Moore, Sharp, Cole are the running backs. Padgett barks out the signals left and right. He is giving it right up the middle to Toby Cole, and it is stopped right at the goal line. He cannot get any closer, probably about a foot short of the goal line. A gain of a good 6 yards on the play. The Greyhounds are threatening here. They are on top 20-14 in the fourth quarter over number one ranked Penn.
Toby Cole, two carries ago across the half-century mark, now at 56 yards rushing for the senior Fireplug fullback.
Two tight end full house formation behind Padgett. Moore, Sharp, Cole are the running backs. Padgett barks out the singles left and right. They give it to Toby. Touchdown, Greyhounds. Toby Cole in the end zone. He picks up his second touchdown of the evening. 26-14. The Greyhounds on top on the Toby Cole 1 yard scamper.
So the Greyhounds move that one 7 plays, 41 yards for the touchdown. And they are on top now, 26-14.
So the Greyhounds will attempt the point after Padgett staying in the ballgame. They are going to go for two.
Just over 6 minutes left to go in the ballgame. The last time the Greyhounds went for two earlier in the ballgame, they were good on a shovel pass to Mike Sharp. Mike Sharp has had all the carries and all the calls on the two-point conversions of the season.
Greyhounds showing the wishbone formation. Two tight ends, but they are split away from the line of scrimmage. Padgett on the option play around the right side. It's a fumble. Sharp picks it up, and he goes in for the two-point conversion. Great heads up and senior leadership play that time by Mike Sharp. The pitch was a little bit high. He might have been able to bring it in. He couldn't, though. It bounced in front of him. He picked it up, retained his composure, and waltzed in for the two more points.
Well, Cap, our score now stands at 28-14. Carmel Graham's on top over to Principal Dr. Dale Graham of Carmel High School. That's the score I picked for our final before the game. I'm pretty happy with my call so far. The Greyhounds on top of number one ranked Penn in the state, 28-14, in what has been the best game of the season.
So the Greyhounds set to kick off here. They will try to keep Penn out of the end zone. About just a little less than 6 minutes left to go in the ballgame. That's what we can estimate here. The scoreboard clock is not working this evening. The back line judge on the field is keeping the official time up here in the press box. We figure it's just a little under 6 minutes left to play.
Well, the Greyhounds starting to taste sweet victory on the sidelines. How much ratings? This would be the upset of the year for them. The best game. Jim Belden said his team is hot and rolling. They're going to stamp the tickets at one station at a time, hopefully sending stamping pins ticket into basketball season.
So Lavant gets into it from the 40-yard line. This is a high but short kick. We field it at the 16-yard line, up to the 20, 25-yard line, breaks it out. Still going, he's on the 40. One man to beat, but he's knocked out of bounds at the 49-yard line right there. That could have been a big play right there. He was hit at the 30-yard line, took it to the outside, and brought it up just short of the midfield.
John Spidell knocking the legs out from the ball carrier saved the Greyhounds. That time there was only about two more men back, and that was going to be real close. So now at the 43-yard line, Penn has it first and 10. Still waiting for the officials to send up the time on the clock, the back judge keeping the official timeout on the field.
Carlton and Penn have got to put it in the air here. Carlton drops back to pass, looking downfield over the right side. It is almost intercepted that time by Mark Lavant. A great effort that time by Tony Cimac, the senior tight end, to bring that one in. He couldn't quite haul it in. Lavant in there on the defensive play, almost picked up the interception.
Now, you know Penn's going to be going long. At least that's what you think. Now, watch for Penn. They've done a lot of countering plays in the game at specific times. Wouldn't be surprised to see some counter plays by the Penn Kingsmen here late in the fourth quarter.
Carlton sets up over center. Hogg, and now he drops back in the shotgun formation. Two men out wide, left and right. He drops back to pass. Penalty flag on the play. Carlton scrambling out to his right. A lot of pressure from behind, and Kennedy drops him from behind. Although a short gain on the play by Carlton. Kennedy in there along with Decatur and Malinchuk. A lot of people in there with the tackle, but there is a penalty flag on the play. It was about a gain of about 6 yards.
The flag thrown right when the ball went. It's going to go illegal motion against Penn. They're going to say that is going to be on the quarterback going into the shotgun formation. There's a hurt player down on the field. We don't know what team he's from, so we're going to take a timeout and find out the hurt player on the field. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
Thank you.
Banking. A package of financial services and sound advice. Only at Indiana National.
Welcome back to Carmel High School. The Hurt Greyhounds still down on the field. We're not exactly positive who it is. We're going to wait and see. We don't want to say anything wrong now. Now, the referees almost sent the play off with all the coaches still down there looking at it. Looks like they could even have the smelling salts out for the Greyhound. As he stands up, it appears to be Josh Malinchuk, a senior lineman for the Greyhounds. He gets up and walks off the field under his own power. He's going to take a seat on the Greyhound bench, and we're going to see trainer Bruce Gordon take a look at Josh Malinchuk. Hopefully he's okay. Now that brings up second down and long because of illegal motion penalty for 5 yards went against the Kingsmen. Second and 15 facing Penn. Split formation behind Carlton. One man out wide to the right. Carlton drops back to pass. Looking downfield. Penalty flag on the play. Looking down right side. Incomplete at the 40-yard line. Intended receiver that time, Mark Sampson. That is the second time we've seen the ball go Sampson's way today. The other one was just over his fingers as this one was. There is a penalty flag on the play. So where that penalty flag is thrown, it's kind of hard to tell what it is. We see the team doctor now checking out Malinchuk.
It is an illegal procedure call against the Penn Kingsmen. So the officials talking things over with the Greyhounds. If they decline the penalty, it will be third and 15. We will see if they mark it off or not. So Carmel Greyhounds on top in the ball game, 28-14. And they do decline the penalty, so it'll be third and 15. This is a big play for the Penn Kingsmen. They must go to the air here. First down marker inside ground territory around the 47-yard line. Carlton over center. One man moving in motion. That is C-Mac. Carlton drops back to pass. Looking downfield, it is complete to C-Mac, and he will not get the first down. He has dropped at the 40-yard line. 45-yard line. A lot of grounds in there, and they were not going to give him that first down. He was dropped well short of the first down. He picked up about 7 yards on the play.
So that's going to bring up fourth down and about seven. Here comes the Penn punt crew. Ryan Vaughn picked up that stop for Carmel. You know, Cap, this late, this could be the last game of the season. We could see Penn go for a fake. A fake has worked against the Greyhounds the last two ball games, so we could see Penn go with a fake.
The Penn Kingsmen look like they're just going to go for it right here. The emotion builds here in Carmel High School. Carlton in the shotgun formation. He drops back to pass. There are penalty flags on the play. That could be an illegal procedure. False start call against either team. The penalty stopped the play. So they will talk things over here and see what the penalty is. And the Greyhounds are saying it is against Penn. And it is a dead ball foul offsides against the Penn Kingsmen. So that could change things here. It's a 5-yard penalty. It'll march it back and it'll be fourth and a very long 11 yards to go for the first down.
We still have not seen the punting crew come in. Penn and their huddle clasped in hands. They're going to go for it. It's fourth and 11. Watch for a counterplay.
Carlton is set in the shotgun formation, sending one man out wide to the right, two tight ends and two men in the backfield in the split formation. Carlton handles his low slap, drops back to pass, and he is dropped for a, he is dropped for an incomplete pass. A lot of pressure there, hurried the throw, incomplete pass. The Greyhounds will take over the football on the 43-yard line of Penn. The Greyhound fans are really getting into the ballgame now.
From Carmel High School, Yancey Gehring and Kep Carmichael bringing you this evening's ball game. Carmel on top, 28-14 over the number one ranked Penn Kingsmen. You see everybody celebrating on the Carmel sidelines. We see somebody on the Penn side set up some form of firework, like an illegal firework. Maybe we'll see the police go after that fan.
Padgett sets up over center, I formation behind him. Tooman out wide, left and right. Sharp gets the call over the right side. Still on his feet, working very hard. He's inside the 40 to around the 36-yard line of Penn.
Mike Sharp has impressed me as much as anybody this evening. That time, Sharp carried the ball for about 6 yards. I have him unofficially for 48 yards on 12 carries. Next one ahead of him is 57 yards.
19 carries for Toby Cole, so they're Sharp has a better average in the ball game. Two tight ends in the T formation for the ground. Second down and about 4 yards to go for the first down. Paget hands the ball off to Cole right up the middle over the 35-yard line to around the 34-yard line. Short game on the play. It'll be third down, and 2 yards for the first down. Harrington checks back into the ball game as Moore comes out. Also, Gunderson checking in the ball game as Ryan Herman comes out, so the grounds will be showing two receivers, one tight end, and a two-back formation behind Paget. They are sending two men out wide to the left. That is Harrington and Gunderson. Pro-set behind Paget, Cole and Sharp. Moore gets the call, and he is lunging forward. The second effort might have got him the first down on the third down play. Toby Cole, the ball carrier on that play for the Greyhounds. So that's going to be short of the first down. That's going to bring up fourth down and a yard. The players are saying they want to go for it. Now it's up to the coaches. Very interesting. About half the Greyhound linemen, Paget, Sharp, and Cole, all turned to Coach Belden and said, let's go for it. They haven't called anything as of yet. They're coming over the sidelines to tell the coaches how much time there is left. They're saying it's fourth down. Reconfirming that with the coaches, we might see the Greyhounds call a timeout. Now Belden talking to Paget. 4 minutes left to go in the ball game. So it's come down to this, 4 minutes to go in the season for one of these two ball clubs. Looking like it could be Penn. So it brings up fourth down. Carmel is definitely going for it. Toby Cole picked up 1 yard on that last play. Toby on the evening with now 60 yards in the ball game, 21 carries. It's about a 3 yard average for him. His running mate in the backfield, Mike Sharp, has 48 yards off 12 carries. Now the Greyhounds call timeout. So we'll take time for this timeout. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
Pizza King Pizza is right next door. Call Pizza King in Carmel for your next pizza or stop by our restaurant at 902 South Rangeline Road. Call 848-7994 for our fast free delivery. Pizza King is open at 11 a.m. Monday through Friday for your lunchtime orders. That makes us That's 848-7994 for Pizza King Pizza.
So the Carmel Greyhounds bring it to the line of scrimmage. Two tight ends and three men in the backfield behind him in the T formation or full house. Greyhounds going it for on fourth and one. Handoff goes to Cole over the left side. That will be good enough for the first down. It looks as if he did call it, although referees are calling timeouts. Depends on where they mark it. If he got the first down or not, they are going to call the timeout, and
they're going to measure. That's very close. Bill Page is saying, hey, I know we've got it. And now it's just the chains. It looks like they're going to get it by a full ball. That's going to be real close. Carmel gets the first down by a full ball length. So Carmel picks up another first down thanks to a Toby Cole 1 yard run. Toby ran for 4 yards in that series. Sharpie ran for 6 yards, so they kept things pretty even on this possession. We know there's about 3:30 left to go in the ball game. The Greyhounds on top, 28-14. Greyhounds now just trying to eat the clock up. Two tight ends in the full house formation. More Sharp, Cole behind Paget. The give is to Cole. Rather, Paget keeps it around the left side, and he has dropped for no gain, maybe a gain of about a half yard, a couple feet maybe, but nothing more than that on the keeper from Paget around the left side. Tim Beeler with the tackle as he dropped Paget hard. Bill looked like he got caught up underneath his own feet and just had to tumble in. So Bill now 36 yards off 7 carries, second and 10 Greyhounds have been awful successful going upstairs. They've had to work a lot harder when they've kept it on the ground, but then you got to remember the clock. There's no reason to get an interception or anything, so you watch the Greyhounds to wind it down and grind it 3 yards in a cloud of dust.
Second down and 10 yards to go. Full house formation behind Padgett. Cole gets the call over the right side. He's over the 30 inside to about the 28-yard line of the Penn Kingsmen. So it'll be third down and 7 yards to go after the 3-yard pickup, rather about a 4-yard pickup. It'll be third down and 6 yards to go for the first down. Padgett getting in the call from Hansman.
Toby Cole has had 20 carries this half and in the ball game. He only had 3 in the first half, and he's exploded now for 63 yards in the second half.
So a lot of motion now behind in the backfield for the Greyhounds. Hansman and Taylor split wide to the right. Two men in the backfield. Cole gets the call, leaping over to the 22-yard line. That 22-and-a-half-yard, 23-yard line of Penn. There will be another very close to the first down. There is a Carmel player down on the field.
The player gets up, keeping an eye on. Now, at center, Todd King down. They're going to take a look at him. I'll tell you what, we'll take 60 seconds here for a timeout. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
Package of financial services and sound advice only at Indiana National.
032.
Welcome back to Carmel High School, Yancey Deering and Kep Carmichael, to update you on what went on when you were gone. The Greyhounds now got a first down. Todd King, the center, was hurt. Now we're yet to see if King is still in the ball game. It's kind of hard to tell in the mass in the huddle, but the Greyhounds did pick up. The Carmel's going to call a timeout, but Bill Padgett sitting right in the face of the referee to see how much time he has, and now he takes a timeout. We know there's under 2 minutes. We're going to keep it here. Carmel, that's a very wise call at this point of the ball game, because that takes up, you know, 25, 30 seconds, and that's when the Greyhounds can really chew things up a little bit more. So every second now is becoming precious for the Greyhounds. Now, Toby Cole has been the big story of the second half for Carmel. He's carried the ball 21 times, picked up 72 yards. Now, Carmel, the record is 32 carries. That was set last year by Mike Grimm, 32 carries in one ball game. And, Cap, if you look down, we see some Carmel Greyhound fans down on the football field. I think we just got a time. There's exactly 1 minute left to go in the ball game. So that's the official time, we believe. And every time they announce, you know, how much time there's left to go, you really see the fans of Carmel just really get hyper. Now the whole defense being lectured now by Coach Keith Fever. Talking now with the whole defense. The offense now is though still on the field. It is second down and 10 from the from the Penn 23-yard line. The Greyhounds still are going with just a two-back formation as of yet, from what we can tell.
So the Greyhounds bring it to the huddle. I formation behind Padgett, Cole, and Sharp, other running backs. Two men out wide to the right. Padgett gives it off to Sharp around the right side. Sharp showing good moves. He's onside the 15-yard line to the 13-yard line. That'll be close to another Greyhound first down. He picked up about 9 yards on the play, so it'll be third down and about a yard to go for the first down. Greyhounds really moving the ball well here in the second half.
So Mike Sharp crosses the half-century mark, 57 yards for the senior tailback off of 14 carries. Both of Carmel's running backs now have jumped over the 50-yard mark, and quarterback Bill Padgett has 36.
Greyhounds on a third and one player, two tight ends in the full house formation. Moore, Sharp, and Cole are the running backs. Padgett gives the ball off to Cole right up the middle. He will be close to a first down, but he may be short by just a little bit. It will be fourth down on a gain of a couple inches that time. It'll be fourth down, well under a minute here left to play in the ball game. Padgett talking to the referee, asking how much time is left, and that is the ball game. Here Graham. From Carmel High School, Greyhounds win it.
Carmel wins the regional for the second year in a row. As we see fans now rushing down onto the sidelines, the Greyhounds win the sectional, the regional, 28-14. They knock off the number one ranked Penn Kingsman. Already we see the media jumping down, interviewing Coach Baldwin. They're going to waste no time. Fans now jumping over the gates. Actually, they have the gate open. Looks like that's a oops. We're not going to look at that. The Greyhounds rush the field. Carmel wins the regional for the second year in a row. They've caught fire, and they just knock off number one ranked Penn. 28-14 is our score. The Carmel Greyhounds now are looking for semi-state action. They will play the winner of the Valparaiso and the Anderson Highland football game that's going on tonight. If you remember, Carmel's already knocked off Anderson Highland handily earlier in the year. And also, the only team to ever beat Carmel in a state championship final football game was Valparaiso. I believe 1976 was the year, defeated by an extra point miss. We see some of the Greyhound teachers, all the fans rushing the field. We're going to have to wait for the Greyhounds to receive the trophy for the regional championship. With that, we're going to take a 60-second booster timeout, come back with our statistics from here, from Carmel High School. The Greyhounds are crowned regional kings. You're listening to the voice of the Greyhounds.
Where do you go when you are poor? You eat pizza board. There's your toppings, incredible fries. Make no mistake, there's just one place. That's us. Go to the very end. Pizza King, Pizza King, Pizza King. We make it go to the very end. Pizza King, Pizza. Go to the very end.
Pizza King Pizza is right next door. Call Pizza King in Carmel for your next pizza or stop by our restaurant at 902 South Rangeline Road. Call 848-7994 for our fast free delivery. Pizza King is open at 11 a.m. Monday through Friday for your lunchtime orders.
That makes us good.
That's 848-7994 for Pizza King Pizza.
Welcome back to Carmel High School, where the Greyhounds have won the regional in the first year that they have gone to the North in postseason play. Now they will play the winner of the Highland Valpo game. Also, the other two teams going North. The Greyhounds win it 28-14. Knocking off the number one ranked Penn Kingsman, Josh Malinchuk, or David Kennedy rather, with the game ball picture taken to him by him as he holds the ball up. The team now huddling around Kennedy. Been an unbelievable game here from Carmel High School. Let's take a quick look at individual stats for the Greyhounds. Toby Cole let him in rushing, 25 carries off 72 yards. Mike Sharp had 57 carries. He carried the pigskin 14 times. The only other rusher for the Greyhounds was Bill Padgett. 36 yards for him off seven carries. The passing category was something to savor if you're a Greyhound fan. Jason Hansman caught one for 22 yards. Mike Sharp caught a 13-yarder, but the big one, tight end number 87, Adam Ritz, caught five passes, two of them touchdowns, one of them a touchdown called back, saying that he was out of bounds. 69 yards in the air for Adam Ritz. We see now the team going crazy down on the field as they take pictures for the Penn Kingsmen, who lose their first game of the season. No Penn fans are leaving yet. It seems like they're all kind of sitting looking at the field. They're very shocked. Penn, taking a look at their rushing statistics, 22 yards, running back Winslow, he had 11 carries. It was 19 yards for Hogg. He had 6 carries. The quarterback, Carlton, 10 yards off 2 carries. Kaufman had a 3-yard carry. Shellstreet with 2 carries with 5 yards. Now taking a look at the receiving, 2 receptions, one of them a 41-yarder for the Penn Kingsmen. The Greyhounds celebrating still on the field with fans. Kep, do you have some team stats for us and the scoring?
The Carmel Greyhounds picked up an amazing 10 first downs in the second half. They were just moving the ball outstanding upfield. They had 119 yards rushing in the second half for a total of 157 yards rushing. And Bill Padgett was 9 for 13 in the air for 107 yards. And total offense for the Greyhounds, unofficially 264 yards. Bill Padgett was intercepted once, and the Greyhounds fumbled one time. Rasmussen was called on to punt 3 times. The Greyhounds were penalized for a total of 30 yards. And that is a big stat right there. The Greyhounds did not give up a lot of yards penalty-wise. Penn Kingsmen were held to 123 total yards offense unofficially. The passing category, Carlton was 4 of 10 for 61 yards. He was intercepted one time. The punter for Penn was called on 3 times. They fumbled the ball twice and were penalized for a total of 23 yards. Quickly going over the scoring in the ball game. Penn broke the ice first with 2 minutes left to go in the first quarter. They charged on 4 plays, 47 yards. Kaufman ran it in from 3 yards out. Point after attempt was good, and the score was 7-0. Then in the second quarter, Padgett hit Adam Ritz on a first of 2 touchdown receptions for Ritz from 12 yards out. The point after attempt from Lavat was no good, wide to the right, and Penn still had a small margin of 7-6. Later in the second quarter, Padgett hit Ritz one more time from 13 yards out this time, capping a 6-play, 69-yard drive. The point after attempt was a 2-point attempt. Padgett hit Sharp on a shovel pass inside, and it was good, so the Greyhounds had the lead for the first time, 7-14. Then in the third quarter, with about 2 minutes left to go, Carlton hit an 11-yard pass to the corner of the end zone, capping a 46-yard drive. The point after was good, and Penn tied it up 14-14. Then in the fourth quarter, Toby Cole ran it in from 9 yards out, capping a 70-yard 10-play drive. The point after attempt was no good by Lavat, blocked by Penn, but the Greyhounds had the lead 20-14. At this point, the Greyhounds were not going to give up that lead at all. With 6:30 left to go in the fourth quarter, Toby Cole ran it in one more time, this from 1 yard out, capping a 7-play, 41-yard drive. The 2-point conversion this time went to Sharp around the right side. It was good. The Greyhounds had the lead 28-14, and that was our final score.
Well, Kep, for those fans who could be listening to the ball game right now, leaving or at home, Carmel will play the winner of the Anderson Highland Valparaiso game. That's the other
Anderson, it's just Highland.
They'll play the winner of the Highland game going north. Now Highland is on top 28-0 in the ball game at halftime. So that's about how we're gonna have to leave it there. So the Greyhounds win it by a score 28-14 to capture regional championship title. Be kind of fun to see what Coach Belden has to say next week on Sports Edge, which you can hear on WHG and CHTV Thursday night at 6 o'clock, where you can call in your questions for Coach Belden. We'd like to thank our engineers back at the studio, Rob Butler and Brian Flegel, and all the engineers have done an excellent job for us this season. So the Greyhounds win it once again, 28-14. They will be in action next week. You can hear it here on WHGE. For Kep Carmichael, I'm Yancey Daring saying so long, everyone, and we'll see you again next week.